because with each new day, game day is filled with wonderment, anticipation, and a few surprises. And last Saturday was no different. As the offense sputtered, a defensive tackle named Sue put six on the board. 30, 20, 10, touchdown Nebraska, and Dominican Sue. With a game on the line, it was Paul, not Joe, who sent Husker Nation into a frenzy in a matter of seconds. Oh my, look out, needs one block. He doesn't need it, he's gonna outrun everybody. Goodbye. With the run game being grounded, it wasn't Lucky, but Roy who put on a halloo of a show.
Outside.
Cuts inside, what a move. Five, touchdown, Nebraska. Tonight, the schedule toughens as the vaunted spread of New Mexico State rolls into Lincoln. What surprises are in store for the Huskers? Find out next on FSN. Nebraska has dominated under the lights of Memorial Stadium, never losing to an unranked team in 22 years, and they hope that continues tonight as they take on the Aggies of New Mexico State in front of yet another sellout crowd at Memorial Stadium. Hello again, everybody. Along with Matt Davison, I'm Ron Thulin. Due to Hurricane Gustav, the September 4th game with Nicholls State and New Mexico State had to be postponed. So this is the Aggies' opening game. That's not real fair, having an opening game against a team that's already played twice.
Well, most coaches will tell you that they see the most improvement from game one to game two. New Mexico State has not played a game yet, and Nebraska is entering game three. That should be an advantage for Nebraska tonight.
Well, let's talk about the advantage Nebraska might have running the football. They are still going to alternate three running backs, but the good news is they could tackle Lydon Murtha back. His first start, hasn't played in the first two games. That's big.
Nebraska's coaches will tell you that Lydon Murtha might be their best offensive lineman. He's really going to bring a lot of physicalness to this offensive line. If you look at the Nebraska rushing stats so far this season with three running backs that they're alternating right now, Nebraska obviously isn't happy with those rushing stats. They think with Lydon Murtha back, that's really going to give them a boost. And I think they hope to see Joe Gans be a little more productive in the running game as well.
Well, let's go back to last week against San Jose State because it was the defense and special teams that really stepped up. First, the defense. You look at that defense, you have to start at the defensive line. Matt, they're playing at such a high level right now.
These coaches went and challenged the defensive line of Nebraska. They said, if we're going to be better on defense, you guys have to be better. Carl Pelini, Bo Pelini, they said, you guys must be better this season. I think the thing that impressed them the most was the athleticism of this Nebraska defensive line. And Dominican Sue, a week ago, picked off a pass that Zach Potter knocked down. He takes it to the house. You really see how these guys lost weight in the offseason. They're more athletic. They're able to move their feet much better. How about this pick from Zach Potter a week ago? Only a few feet away from the quarterback. I can't tell you how great a play that is for a defensive lineman. Great hands. These guys have really been the staple of the Nebraska defense so far this season. They hope to carry that into the game today.
Well, last week it was nail-biting time in the fourth quarter because the score was just 14-12, a two-point lead for the Huskers. That's when the special teams took over, and they sparked a 21-point fourth quarter. It was much needed.
I don't think anybody thought Nebraska would be in a 14-12 game with San Jose State here at Memorial Stadium, but maybe the key play of the game was on the special teams in that fourth quarter, and it came from Niles Paul. At 14-12, he takes the kickoff and takes it all the way to the house. Niles Paul, the sophomore from Omaha, Nebraska, showing that great blazing speed down the sidelines. Great teams find a way to win games, even when you're not at your best, Ron. Last week it was defense, and it was special teams in Nebraska that really lifted them.
Well, the defense is going to have to lift them tonight because they are going to be challenged by Hal Mumme's air raid offense. Now, they've got a quarterback, Chase Holbrook. He's a senior. This guy holds 36 of the 47 offensive records for New Mexico State. Coach is telling us yesterday, Matt, this guy is really good.
Oh, he could really play. And if Nebraska doesn't put pressure on him today, it could be a long day for Nebraska's defense. Now, he's not a guy that's going to beat you with his legs, but when he's standing in the pocket and he has time, he will pick you apart. Over 3,800 yards a year ago, 26 touchdowns through the air. Chase Holbrook will play in the NFL someday, and he's looking to have a big day against Nebraska's defense here today. And he has a bunch of wide receivers that are really quick, not great size, but they're really quick in the secondary. Nebraska is going to be challenged today.
Well, you know, one of the things they're going to be challenged, obviously, is this air raid defense. But, Matt, they've got Missouri. You've got Texas Tech coming up. This is an opportunity to see exactly how good some of those young defensive backs are. And can you get pressure from that front four in a situation like this?
The main thing is that you try to get pressure without having to blitz. Now, you will see Nebraska blitz today, no doubt about it. But that front four of Nebraska has to try to get pressure, and if they don't, it will put a lot of pressure on Nebraska's secondary.
But isn't it feast or famine with a blitz? At times, they've got to be careful.
At times, you can get beat, especially with these wide receivers of New Mexico State. If they catch it, they can make a guy miss and take it all the way to the house. So Nebraska's going to have to be picky and choosy today when they go to blitz.
Well, not only do they have kind of a funny defense, they also have, or a funny offense, they've got a funny defense. They play the 3-3-5, which West Virginia has had success doing, but that's a defense that Nebraska can't get, make it too complicated, right?
No, I don't think so. 3-3-5 defense, most people say, what in the world is that? You're going to see it today, some of the time from New Mexico State. They might have 8 or 9 guys at times standing up when the ball is snapped. Nebraska's going to be faced with a bunch of different looks from this defense. It's going to be interesting to see how they react to that. I think Joe Gans has to have a big day today for Nebraska to be successful.
Well, Bo Pelini is standing in front of the team in the tunnel. He is ready to bring the Huskers out on the field to see if they can make it 3-0 this year as they take on New Mexico State. Let's join them in the tunnel. Absolutely a perfect night for football. We are glad you're with us. We are moments away from the opening kickoff with New Mexico State and the Huskers of Nebraska. Just how beautiful of a night it is. Temperature right now in the 80s. It'll probably be in the low 70s, high 60s by the fourth quarter, but it is a perfect night for football. And those of you in the Lincoln and Omaha area know that the weather has not been the greatest the last couple of days. Short sleeve shirts seem to be the attire for tonight. 292nd consecutive sellout. The official capacity is just over 81,000, but they're expecting a little more than 84,000 tonight. Well, the third member of our broadcast team, we are glad he is with us tonight. He's Larry Putney, be roaming the sidelines. Larry, how you doing tonight?
Very good. Thanks, Ron. You know, at the beginning of the season, this defensive line from the 2008 squad was expected to be one of the stronger positions. They returned every person in that top two across the entire defensive line. But that depth has been tested a little bit. Barry Turner went down last week, of course, with the broken bone in his leg. That means Pierre Allen is getting his opportunity. And this kid is a phenomenal athlete. Not only did he lead Nebraska last week with 10 tackles and 3 tackles for losses, his best sport in high school might have been basketball. He led his team to back-to-back state basketball championships. Not only was he the MVP, but he was Mr. Basketball 2 straight years in Colorado. A phenomenal athlete gets the start tonight for the Huskers.
All right, Larry, I know you're going to be having more for us as the night goes on. Look forward to seeing you. And New Mexico State won the toss. They have decided to receive. Julius Fleming and Marcus Anderson are back. And there's a good look at Adi Kanalix. 9 of 16 kickoffs have been touchbacks. That's the third most in the NCAA.
You know, if you're New Mexico State in this game, Ron, I think you're glad you get the ball first. I don't know that you want to come out and let Nebraska drive it down your throat and get behind right away. I think the strength of this New Mexico State team is their offense. I think you put Chase Holbrook out there to start the game. I think they like this.
And we are underway. Glad you're with us tonight. And another outstanding kick. It'll be 3 yards deep. They tell him to take a seat. Such an advantage for Nebraska when you have somebody that can put it in the end zone. Now the New Mexico State offense, as we talked about, is called the Air Raid. Chase Holbrook, 6'5", 246 pounds. He's a senior out of First Texas. He caught the attention of the Nebraska defense as he's completed 70% of his passes last year, 26 touchdowns, but he also threw 18 interceptions, which tells me, Matt, he makes bad decisions at times.
There are times, especially if he gets a little confused. So look for Nebraska's defense to really switch it up early on in this game.
A little pump fake. He's looking to go deep. Nobody there. Going down the middle in double coverage. Pass incomplete off the back of Larry Asante, who says, not today. But, Larry, you better look, because Chris Williams looked like he had a step on him.
Chris Williams can really run. Chase Holbrook here was looking for the bubble screen out to the left. He fakes that pass and then was going to go deep down the left sideline to the man that was going to block for the bubble screen. That wasn't there either, so he went deep to Chris Williams. Good coverage there by Larry Asante, staying home in the middle of the football field.
Now here's an interesting formation. This is what they do differently than the Texas Tech offense of Mike Leach. And they snap it to the halfback. They try a little end around with Markwell Colston. The Colston is shoved out of bounds at the 35-yard line. That'll be good for a first down. Let's take a look at this line for the Texas, or for the New Mexico State and New Mexico Aggies. Three sophomores, two seniors. Bolin and Gutierrez seem to be the anchors of the line. And the skill position, they really don't have a run game. That was kind of odd. But Harris, Williams, and Neiman, over 180 receptions combined. They are very, very good. First and 10 for New Mexico State. Just about 30 seconds gone by here in the opening quarter. Remember, San Jose State, they struck first last week. Holbrook steps up in the pocket, passes complete to Neiman. The official goes down. He picks up about five on the play. The Nebraska defense, they need to get four-man pressure. The line's been outstanding. Ty Steinkuhler, already more tackles than all of last season. The linebackers. Obviously, we have Cody Glenn, Phillip Dillard, Tyler Wartman in there, but he goes out on the nickel. And you can't let New Mexico State know where your safeties are. O'Hanlon will start at free safety. Amukamara will start for West at cornerback. Second down and about five. They'll try to run it. Over the left side, they get a first down with Brandon Perez, who last year was a fullback. This year, he's going to be playing a little tailback. Interesting so far for New Mexico State. Two runs.
Two more runs than we thought. We might see the entire game right here in the first few plays.
Quickly, the no-huddle offense. Sometimes they're hurry, sometimes they're not.
Either way, Chase Holbrook is going to get them into the play that they want to run. They put a lot of responsibility on this quarterback.
First and 10. Four-man rush. Holbrook with time. Here comes some pressure. Into the flat, pass is complete at the 49-yard line to Chris Williams, the senior out of Rio Rancho, New Mexico, 56 receptions last year. Here's what makes Holbrook so good.
Well, when he stands in the pocket, he feels so comfortable. Look how he just moves his feet just enough to give himself time to get rid of the football. That just comes with experience.
No interceptions coming into this game, 55 straight passes. They try the run game. This time the D-line of the Huskers up to the challenge. Tony Glenn, the junior out of Lubbock, Texas, averaged over 5 yards a carry last season. He stopped for little or no gain. Cody Glenn already with 17 total tackles this season on the stop. Third down, we'll call it two, Matt.
An early third down that might be pretty important in this game.
And it is loud. You can see the hand signals by the offensive lineman. Four-man pressure. Holbrook spots up, throws for the first down, down to the 43-yard line. A.J. Harris on the reception. He's New Mexico State's all-time leading receiver. Cody Glenn was on the coverage. Boy, just the patience Holbrook has.
It's good coverage. See all the time that Chase Holbrook has in the pocket here. When you see guys running all over the football field, ends up two guys right in the middle.
Now they go a little on the right side, and they get inside the 30-yard line. Another first down for New Mexico State. It was Chris Williams. So they're showing a little versatility on offense already tonight.
Trying to run it a little misdirection, getting the ball in different guys' hands. That's one thing you hear Coach Mummy talk about, trying to spread the football around to different playmakers.
This is the eighth play already of this drive. played just about 3 minutes. This time they're going to try the running game with Colston again. He is caught for maybe a yard gain. Boy, they like to sometimes snap it to one of the halfbacks and kind of fake you out. Eric Haig kept his position, did a nice job from the cornerback spot.
And if Haig doesn't make this play, it's a big gainer for New Mexico State. A little bit of trouble on the handoff there, but out in space, what a good tackle in the open field there by Eric Haig.
This is a young offensive line, and so far they're doing a nice job. Can they keep it up? Second down and 8. Ball's on the 26. Holston again. Tries to get to the corner. Does. Tiptoes out of bounds. Luke Amara is the one that pushed him out. There is the head coach with his familiar towel around his neck. He's got the little Jerry Tarkanian look working there. Hal Mumme in his fourth year. Originally out of San Antonio, Texas. Began his coaching career as a high school coach in Corpus. First stop at college was Iowa Wesleyan. He went to Valdosta State, from there to Kentucky, Southeast Louisiana, and now New Mexico State.
And he's a player's coach.
Absolutely. Third down and 3. Four down linemen for Nebraska. They bring 5. Holbrook buying some time, looking, has a man wide open inside the 15, the 10. Down to the 8-yard line is Marcus Anderson, the junior college transfer from Austin, Texas. They call him the second fastest guy on the team. He's a little booger at 5'8", 166.
Well, they have a bunch of guys that can really fly on the outside. When you give Chase Holbrook this much time and wide receivers that know how to work while he's working behind the line of scrimmage, look at him sit down right there in the hole. You don't need to go anywhere. No need to run away from a defender if there's nobody right on top of you. And Chase Holbrook's going to find you when you're that wide open.
Nebraska not getting the pressure. First and goal. Holbrook has some pressure, still completes the pass. Down to the 3-yard line. That'll be a pickup of about 4 on the play. Holbrook got a whack on that one. At least they got some pressure.
Nebraska brings an extra body. Holbrook finds himself with a little pressure. Ty Steinkuhler coming in to get the hit on him, but he delivered the football well. He doesn't have, you know, the legs that are going to beat you, Ron, but right. He can move just enough to find himself enough time.
This time the Nebraska defense says absolutely nothing, Mr. Perez. Well, one thing that Nebraska did last week, they did slow the spread when they got inside the red zone, man.
Well, that's big, big averages right there. Look at the difference. Outside Nebraska's 25-yard line, giving up over 6 yards a play. But once they got in the red zone, this Nebraska defense really stiffened up, only at 1.4 yards per play.
Perez and Glenn in the backfield. Third and goal. Looking for the left corner. Now tries the middle. Incomplete. No flag thrown. Good defense, Nebraska, by Matt O'Hanlon.
Matt O'Hanlon on the coverage. Chase Holbrook stepped up in the pocket. Had enough time. A little crossing route right over the top of the goal line. Timing was pretty close there.
Yeah, it was very close. Watch that left arm, or the right arm. No.
I think that was a good play by Matt O'Hanlon.
Well, here's where New Mexico State is struggling. They've got all new kickers. This is Kyle Hughes, a freshman out of Columbia, South Carolina. They say he's got a strong leg. This one's blocked! Zach Potter is the one who got the hand on it. Second week in a row, Potter comes up with a big play. Outstanding. Plays for New Mexico State, and they get a goose egg as the kick is blocked.
Who has the power to harness energy? University of Nebraska Lincoln Research finds answers to global problems. With leading-edge science, we explore renewable energy, reduce the impact of drought, conserve and protect our natural resources. It's clear. The University of Nebraska Lincoln helps keep the planet green. Now that's the power of red.
This is Nebraska. home of champions. The nation's finest student athletes. Success in athletics, academics, and life. Nebraska, the power of red.
Pepsi product. One thing Bo Pelini told us yesterday is they want a fast start. I wouldn't qualify that as a fast start, although it was a good start because you blocked the field goal.
Well, not exactly how you drop the first defensive series. Look at Zach Potter get that big left mid up there. At 6'7", when he jumps, and he was a great basketball player. We talked about the athleticism of this defensive line. And you know what? When you're in a pass rush or when you're trying to block a field goal like that, you're 6'7", and you've got a vertical that's over 30 inches like Zach Potter, you can really get up there.
The senior out of Omaha, Nebraska, Zach Potter, had the interception last week. He's a former tight end. So the Huskers will take over. First and 10 from their own 12-yard line. 9:16 left to play in the first quarter. Marlon Lucky, everybody is hoping he gets on track tonight. And he'll have his first carry over the right side. Got some running room. Isn't that amazing? He goes behind the blocks of Slosson and Murtha. No shock there as we take a look at Joe Gans going up against this 3-3-5 defense. He's completing 61% of his passes. Since he is a timing quarterback, Matt, how important is it to get him in a rhythm early in this game?
Well, there's no doubt he's a rhythm quarterback. When he starts to get in a groove, he can be tough to stop. Last week, San Jose State did a good job of not letting him get into that groove.
Pickup of 6 on the play. Looking for a little option. Gans keeps it. Has some legs over the 35, over the 40. Just what you talked about, Matt, in the open. They got to get him running the ball a little more.
That just gives you another threat on offense. We have a quarterback that can run the ball. A little option here, old school for Nebraska. Make the rush and commit. He doesn't commit, you get up underneath it. Joe Gans, not gonna kill you with his legs, but he's effective.
And Nebraska now, after the 26-yard run by Joe Gans, 32 is his career long. He had that against Western Michigan. Take over first and 10. The little swing pass to Swift. Tries to get a block on the outside. Slips the tackle. Gets into Aggie territory down to the 45-yard line. And let's take a look at the rest of the offensive starters for the Huskers. As we mentioned, Murtha is back after missing the first two games. The right side, Murtha and Slosson. One word, stout. Skill position. Still will alternate the three backs. Peterson, Swift, not only catching the ball effectively this year, but they're also blocking well. There's big Leiden Murtha coming off that two games, fighting that infection. Second team Big 12 last year.
He's a big guy on that right side. You put him with Matt Slosson, you might see Nebraska run over there a lot.
And we have a little motion penalty. That's going to be on Nebraska. 4 false starts last week. This team's averaging 9 penalties a game already.
Offense number 44. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
And that'll just drive a coach nuts, Ron.
Yeah.
Starting off with a good drive here. And then you get a penalty. Just puts you back there. First and 15.
First and 15 from the 49-yard line.
And those are just penalties that are mental errors, not concentrating on what the snap count is in the huddle.
Now Bo and Carl, along with the linebacker coach, trying to figure out what's going on, is Lucky over the left side, gets up to the original line of scrimmage. And that's one of the things, Matt, as a former player, and Bo was talking about it yesterday extensively with us, he wants guys to be tired mentally as well as physically after a practice and a ball game. Because he said mentally we made more mistakes in the run game than we did physically last week.
Well, and I think that's why you look at those rushing statistics and they're not up to par. It's not only because physically they aren't able to get it done, it's because mentally they're having one guy out of those 5 on every play. It just isn't quite getting it done. And a lot of times it's a mental error.
Young goes in motion, State straight drop. They're going left side looking for Swift. Incomplete. Marvin Betts, the senior out of San Diego, California.
Incomplete.
was on the coverage. Let's take a look at New Mexico State's defense. Jolie Dunn's 3-3-5. Long and Anderson in the front, just 260 pounds. The linebacker, Scott and Connor, they're going to be treated like defensive ends. And in the secondary, Derek Richardson at free safety. They call him a safety net for the DBs. Now, Davin House, he's the quarterback, or the cornerback that was kind enough to provide the Huskers with a little bulletin board material this week. And we do thank him for that. Third down, they'll call it 9. Gann straight drop, no pressure, looks out the flat, caught. Peterson's got the first down. House, who was popping off about the receivers for Nebraska, was on the coverage. I wonder if he'd like to rethink his quote.
Todd Peterson lined up out there on the edge, along mentally, Colt, little flag route to the outside, and House was just late getting there. Nice throw and catch on a big 3rd and 9 early in this game for Joe Gans.
And the Huskers with a nice little run going. Now Tifa Tiller lines up in the fullback spot. Lucky. Penalty flag goes down to the 22-yard line. It's good to see Lucky making people miss tonight.
Well, he's been more effective here in the first quarter than we've seen him all year long so far early.
And our official tonight, referee is Ken Richens.
Offside, defense number 97. Penalty decline, result of the play, second down.
We're talking about Davin House. Here's what he said. We believe our receivers are 10 times better than their receivers. And Todd Peterson said, I don't think I'm going to say anything. Would you have said anything?
And what a smart
comment. No. Would you have said anything?
If I were Todd Peterson?
Yes.
Well, I don't know. I'm much more mature now, Ron, than I was back then.
Ladies and gentlemen, you can hear the tap dancing from the booth. Here's Lucky. Looks for a block. Just takes a wallop as he gets back to the line of scrimmage. And Davin House, sorry, Davin, didn't mean to pick on you. He's the one who lowered the boom on him.
Well, and he was asked the question, as a secondary, do you think you guys are prepared going into this game when Nebraska's already played 2 games? And he said, well, yeah, we're prepared. And you'd expect him to say something that was confident, like, yes, we're prepared. But you wouldn't think he'd follow it up with, we're prepared because our wide receivers are 10 times better than theirs.
Yeah, really. Well, that's not exactly the thing to say. Third down and just 2. Peterson in motion. Gans looking for Peterson. He's got him inside the 20. He's got the first down. Down to the 17-yard line. That's 2 catches. Not bad.
I can tell you as a wide receiver, though, when somebody says something like that, you might have a little bit more motivation. Todd Peterson with a couple of big third down catches already in this game. Didn't get a lot of yards after catch, as you see, but effective on 3rd and 2. Just get the first down and move the chains.
Peterson already 2 catches. He's got 9 on the year. New set of downs for the Huskers. We move inside of 5 minutes of the first. A little mix up in the backfield. Lucky trying to make chicken salad. Got back to the line of scrimmage. Maybe picked up a half a yard on the play. We talked about the mental mistakes. Is this a missed assignment, man?
We'll see right in the middle. A little mix up in the backfield. Yeah. The timing was off on the handoff, and that just allowed the defense to react. It was tough to tell if there was a missed assignment up front, but I think it was miscommunication with Joe Gans and Marlon Lucky.
There you take a look at Bo Pelini, very upbeat with us yesterday. He knows this team's coming along. Lucky and Castile now in the backfield. Straight drop, here comes 5. Gans is hit as he lets go. He is leveled on the play.
That was a blitz from Joe Gans' blind side. He just didn't see. Is that Watts? Is that a? You couldn't see who that was that hit him, but he took. He really lowered the boom on him there. I'll tell you.
Looked like Jamar Cotton, number 11. Well, that sets up a 3rd down and 9. Ball's on the 17-yard line. Castile now in the backfield. Jolie Dunn yelling instructions to his defense. They bring a bunch. Gans scrambling for his life. Gets to the outside. Throws across his body. Incomplete. Pass defended by Betts. Intended for Peterson.
And even though Joe Gans didn't complete that pass, Even though he didn't complete that pass, Ron, you see what having a quarterback that can at least move out of the pocket does for you. If that was Chase Holbrook, it would have been a sack. Joe Gans gets out of the pocket and at least gives himself an opportunity to make a play.
Well, I think Bo was thinking about going for it, but instead they're going to go try to the field goal attempt. They'll spot it at the 25-yard line. It'll be a 35-yard attempt. And of course, Alex, so far this year, 4 of 4, all coming in the Western Michigan game. Good snap, good hold. And no good. His first miss in 2 years. Slid it to the right. 12 straight field goals made has come to an end. The snap was good, the hold was good, and we remain scoreless in Lincoln.
Husker fans, don't miss your chance to be part of the action at the Devaney Center this fall.
Go! A bottle of Don by Dockers Arrow. Highlight reel.
2008-2009 Nebraska men's basketball season ticket packages are on sale now and start at only $99. To get your tickets, visit Huskers.com or call 1-800-8-BIG-RED. Nebraska basketball. Play hard as one. Cheer hard as one.
Honor the past and invest in the future by contributing to the new Nebraska Student Life Complex. Located on the west side of Memorial Stadium, the Student Life Complex will nearly triple the size of Nebraska's Hewitt Center for Student Athletes, providing current and future Huskers more space, resources, and technology to continue Nebraska's rich academic tradition. For more information, go to Huskers.com.
So 4 minutes and 4 seconds left to be played in the opening stanza. Both teams have had impressive drives. Both teams have missed field goal attempts, but the surprise was from Alex Henry, who was 4 for 4 this year, 12 for his last 12.
Well, he's a really good kicker, and you'd expect him to knock this one right through the uprights. Something went wrong there because he missed that one by 20 feet to the right, and he was right in the middle of the football field. He wasn't even on a hash. I don't expect to see that again out of Alex Henry. He's one of the really good weapons for Nebraska in the special teams game.
Well, as soon as he hit it, he turned. He knew it was gone. It was not any good. Well, here the high-potent offense of New Mexico State. Their opening drive covered 14 plays, 77 yards. And they begin 1st and 10 from their own 20. There's the numbers for Holbrook.
And the most impressive stat on there to me, Ron, is that completion percentage.
Yeah.
70% is just insanely good. And when you reach over 3,800 yards, you see why.
Here comes the blitz. Holbrook reads it, dumps it off. Pickup of 2 on the play to A.J. Harris. Nice job, though, by Prince Amakamara coming up from that cornerback spot. He trailed him the entire way.
You see the short crossing route. Chase Holbrook looking to his right, comes to the second option, quickly across the middle, and Amukamara was right there to pull him to the ground after a short gain.
2nd and 8, 3.5 to play here in the opening quarter. 3 wide receivers to the left. Hand off to Perez. Nice job defense. Stacking him up right at the line of scrimmage. Phillip Dillard's leading the challenge. 8 tackles last week for Carl Pellini against San Jose State.
Nebraska with 6 defensive backs in the game on that play. And when they have 5 DBs, it's nickel, and when they have 6, it's dime, and that's your dime back right there, Lance Thorell. And even though he didn't clean it up, he slowed him down enough and allowed Phillip Dillard to come in and finish him.
A lot better tackling on that play than we saw last week. 3rd down and 8. The deep pass intended for Neiman, not anywhere close. Armando Murillo is with him step for step, and the defense steps up and stops him. Holds him to just 2 yards on that possession. Much better.
One of the things the Pellinis talked to this defense about was trying to get 50% of the time get a 3 and out this week. They really harped on that all week long. They said they practiced well, and they expected them to play well defensively.
Now, Kyle Hughes is, once again, the freshman out of Columbia, South Carolina, who's been sick the last couple of weeks. He's lost 17 pounds. He's set to kick it away, and the left footer gets a good one. Peterson. Or Swift, I should say. Up over the 40-yard line, and Nebraska with outstanding field position. Let's check in with Larry. Larry.
Well, thanks, Ron. You know, we talked to Bo and Carl yesterday, and the goal of this defense this week, they made a point of it. They want three and outs. Last week, they didn't think there was enough urgency on defense, so they made a point. 50% three and outs for the game. Right now, guys, they're 50%.
That was a big point, as you mentioned, Larry, yesterday. And you know, talking to Carl and about this offense, and he was, you know, a lot of people make a lot of, about Mike Leach's offense, and Mike actually got it from Al Mummy, who got it from Lavelle Edwards. But he said, listen, when they don't huddle, that's almost easier for us. He likes it.
Yeah, because they're not running guys in and out. If teams are huddling and they're running four, five, six guys on and off the field, you have to match your defensive personnel against what the offense is putting out there. If they're not substituting on offense, you know what you need to have out there, whether it's four DBs and a base defense, five defensive backs and a nickel, or if you're going to go with six and a dime defensive package.
Well, he's already had an effect on his defense. Those of you in 2003 will remember that. They were around in 2003. You can see what he did there, and you can see the improvement already this year. And especially, I think, the thing that stands out with me is the sacks.
Well, that's big.
13 a whole year, and you have only 11 takeaways. You already have four. That's huge.
Those are big, big numbers. And, you know, one of the things that I remember Bo Pelini saying before he coached a game this season, he said, when I ask my players to do something, I believe they're going to do it. And if he makes it a point to say, we want to get takeaways, we want to rip at the football, we want to get turnovers, then they're going to be thinking about that all the time. He said, if I ask them to give great effort, I believe they're going to give great effort on every play because I asked them to. Sometimes it's as simple as just asking your guys to do something for you. And when you have a coach that you really like, you'll do those things for him.
Huskers averaging over 7 yards rushing per carry. And here's Gans already with a long run himself. This time he keeps it again, cuts up front. Able to get up to about the 48-yard line. That'll be a pickup of about 6 on the play. Michael Zant, a true freshman out of Midland, Texas, coming up to make the stop. You know, coming into this game, and I find it ironic, Matt, that there were only two rushes better than 20 yards. For Nebraska. They got one tonight, so that's 3 on the season. And Bo Pelini would like to see it, but he or Sean Watson, they're not impatient about it.
No, they're not feeling the pressure, I guess you'd say, to improve the running game. Obviously, they want to be more effective in the rushing game, but they're not, like you said, being impatient and putting pressure on their players. They're saying, hey, we need to do a better job of coaching you and calling better plays at better times. And then once we get everybody healthy, watch out.
Well, 30-second timeout called by Nebraska with 2 minutes and 4 seconds left. And picking up on that, one of the things Sean Watson was talking to us about the more volume of run plays this week, they gave them more, but they cut down the number of plays. Obviously, you know, he understands, and there's a great look at Sean Watson, who was very successful at Colorado in adapting his offenses. He understands that they've got to run the football, but you've got to also understand that Michigan, Western Michigan and San Jose State were giving them the pass.
Yeah, they were really stacking the box, 8 and 9 guys in there, and there's only so much you can do in that situation. And so, you know, he is going to be patient with this offensive line. They want to fill these guys with confidence.
Second down and 5 for the Huskers. Lucky breaks over the right side. Down to the 40-yard line before Brandon Bayamonte makes the stop.
Marlon Lucky already more effective in this game. You'll see one little cut. See everybody just blocking everybody down to the right side. And Marlon Lucky, one little cut back, and he squirted right through there for a big gainer.
How about that? Last year, he had almost more yards than the entire Aggie team and almost more touchdowns rushing the football. First and 10. No penalty flag. Gann steps up, throws, has a man wide open inside the 25 down line, down to the 20. Mike McNeil with his second reception of the year. House on the cover, so House has been beaten a couple of times tonight already.
His wide receivers to work down the field. Instead of just running the ball upfield there, he stays behind the line of scrimmage, allows himself to buy time there, and Mike McNeil works outside of the play. You work on that scramble drill, and Mike McNeil found an opening there, sat down in the hole.
Pickup of 22 on the play, his longest of his career. Fresh set of downs. Gann sees some pressure, throws it out to Lucky. Gets down to about the 15-yard line before he's knocked out of bounds by Derek Richardson, the free safety. Another impressive drive for this Husker offense.
But when you get down here, you want to stuff that thing in. Gans looks to the left, retreats, allows the defense to chase after him, and just dumps it off to the right side there to Marlon Lucky. Really makes those defensive linemen nervous to get too far upfield when you run those screen passes. So you just dump it right over the top of them. Those big guys don't like that.
Couple of tight ends now for the Huskers. Lucky going over the big right side again inside the 10, and he has another first down. If you don't think Slauson and Murtha make a difference, you just hide behind them.
Two pretty big bodies over there, and you've seen Nebraska early in this first quarter really try to run over that right side. They put a tackle over there too with Young, and look at the just mowing people down the field. And as a running back, it's easier for you to run downhill when there's a little bit of a gap.
And it's first and goal now. Lucky, looking's got it. Touchdown, Nebraska. Lucky's third rushing touchdown of the year. Once again, making people miss and being very patient running the football.
And an impressive drive there for Nebraska. Getting down there the first time, missing a field goal, getting it back, driving it right down again, and sticking it in there and taking a 7-0 lead.
And the extra point is good, 6-for-6 on the year. Good drive for the Huskers. Six plays, 58 yards, used just over 2 minutes and 20 seconds, and Nebraska is first to strike.
Good job by this offensive line. You see Mike Huff from the left guard position pull around there. Marlon Lucky actually puts his left hand on Huff's back and just reads that block, cuts around him to the outside, in there for the touchdown.
As a player, do you think Marlon Lucky was a little frustrated over the three running back system? Because I talked to Roy Helu yesterday. He and Quentin Castile both told me yesterday, no, we're just glad we're all playing. But do you think Marlon Lucky, who had such a great year last year, would be frustrated?
You know, I don't think so, especially early in the year. And he knows when talking to Sean Watson that he's going to get his touches. You know, I don't think he needs to worry about that. He's still really, when it comes down to it, the number one back. But after having a great season a year ago and then coming out the first two games here and only having 66 total yards rushing in the first two games, maybe that's frustrating. Mm-hmm. But not to the point that he's angry with his teammates or anything. I just think he wants to be better. And what you want out of your players at that point is you demand more out of yourself. You practice harder, and you go out there, and that motivates you to get it done at a higher level.
Well, that got the crowd of 84,000-plus excited. 13 seconds left here in the opening quarter. Each team's had the ball twice here in the opening stanza. Anderson and Williams back. It's going to be Anderson. A little razzle-dazzle, a little handoff over to Williams now. Nebraska doesn't buy it. He gets to the 21-yard line. O'Hanlon coming up to make the stop. We told you that Hal Mumme has got a bag of tricks. You know,
that was just an odd play. You see him run up and just hand it off, and then another handoff. So watch for that later in the game if New Mexico State receives another kickoff, if they just don't give it to him.
I think that when they decided to do that, that Williams was the bottle cap and Anderson was a piece of paper when they designed it. I think. I may be wrong. Final 7 seconds here of the quarter. Colston in the backfield. Holbrook looks to put it up. Down the middle, overthrows his intended receiver, Anderson. And that should do it here in quarter number one.
That one just got away from Holbrook.
Yeah. Chase Holbrook and company, they put up some yardage. They put up 80 yards in the ball game, but they missed a field goal after having it blocked. Nebraska misses a field goal, but then Marlon Lucky puts him on the board.
And welcome back to Memorial Stadium, along with Ron Thulin and Matt Davis, and I'm Larry Putney. The Huskers on top of the Aggies, 7-0 as we head toward the second quarter. Joining me now is former Husker Lombardi Trophy winner and won 3 national championships in 4 years, Grant Wistrom. Great to have you back. When you were introduced at the beginning, inducted into the Nebraska Hall of Fame, you threw the bones, the place went nuts. What was that like for you to be back here at Memorial Stadium and hear that?
It's always great to come back to Nebraska. I spent 4 of the best years of my life here, and anytime you get to walk on the field of Memorial Stadium is a good time, a good day.
I know you're very proud of your black shirt tradition. It disappeared for a couple of years. What do you think about the direction they're headed in now?
I'm excited about it. The last few years they've struggled, and to me it's not about wins and losses. It's just seeing a team out there playing hard and playing together, and I think Coach Pelini's definitely got that attitude. Any business takes on the attitude of its leader, and he's definitely a fiery personality and type of guy, and the guys are going to play harder. That's why I'm excited about that.
Something else that didn't disappear, but there was certainly a de-emphasis, was on the walk-on program. And I know when you were a player, you always talked about how those guys set the tempo. Talk about the reemergence of this walk-on program here.
It's not going to do anything but help this program. I mean, we went out there, you had guys that had opportunities to play college football at other schools, but they walked on at Nebraska because they lived and died for the Cornhuskers. And every Monday through Friday was their Saturday. And they went out there and worked hard every Saturday and made us better. And that's why we went out there and won so many games on Saturday afternoon.
Grant, great to see you back at Memorial Stadium.
Good to be here, Larry. Thanks.
You talk about passion. He played with it, Matt.
Oh, my goodness. One of the best Huskers to ever live. And he played with as much or more passion than anybody ever has wearing that uniform.
Anderson goes in motion, 2nd and 10. Keep it on the ground. Wes Neiman, a little razzle and very little dazzle. Pierre Allen on the stop. Of course, he started for Barry Turner out. We wish Barry the very, very best. Was having an outstanding year in the first couple of games. Pierre Allen says, I'm ready to step in and do it. Comes up with 10 tackles last week.
Well, Larry talked about his athleticism, and the thing is, he's going to have to play more downs now than he's ever played. So Nebraska becomes a little bit thin at that rush end position, so their conditioning is going to be ultra important the rest of the year.
3rd down, New Mexico State, 2 of 4. Here comes the blitz. Holbrook has to let it fly. That pass is up for grabs, and they come down with it. Chris Williams, an outstanding job.
And give Chase Holbrook credit for standing there in the face of danger, because he's about to get lit up on the blitz, and he just throws it up there, and little Chris Williams goes up and comes down with it on a big 3rd down conversion for the Aggies.
Chris Williams, the senior out of Rio Rancho, New Mexico, played only 8 games last year, didn't play the last 5 because of a shoulder injury, still had 56 receptions. 1st and 10, rushes 4 guys. Holbrook has time. Now he just slides. You talked about his not lack of running ability, but the fact he doesn't do it a whole lot. We saw it there. Smart move, though, for the senior.
I'm a little shocked he ran the wishbone in high school.
At LD Bell in Dallas, outside of Dallas, Fort Worth.
But here he's just trying to get back to the line of scrimmage and not take a big loss.
No gain on the play, 2nd and 10. Neiman and Colston now in the backfield. They'll move people all over the place. Anderson in motion. Holbrook going deep down the right side. There's a red jersey there. Intercepted by Murillo. He's got a convoy in front of him. Down at the 20-yard line, 55 yards on the return.
Armando Murillo was in perfect position to make this play. Playing a deep 3rd down the right side of the field, and Chase Holbrook just let that one float, and it was overthrown, and Murillo was there to pick it off, and he kept his feet. And there's nothing more a defender likes than to have a bunch of guys out in front of him after he picks a ball off. Nebraska did a great job there.
Four interceptions on the year for the Huskers. Watch the halfback pass. Gans is open. He's got him. Touchdown, Nebraska. Open on this.
Well, college football is a game of momentum, and Nebraska had it after the interception, and why not try to deliver a knockout punch? We might have seen a little of that in practice this week, Ron.
And the extra point is good. That's Lucky's third touchdown pass in Nebraska history, and Joe Gans has a reception for a touchdown. And the Huskers lead it 14-0.
Well, you know, I didn't really do a lot of cheerleading. And I was usually on the sideline with headphones. And I was really pretty deep in thought, and but I would like to leave you with this, and that is, go Big Red.
For technology to advance as rapidly as it has, technology education must advance even faster. The University of Nebraska has built an institute that will impress even the world's most sophisticated technology-based companies. Because the world's most sophisticated technology-based companies help design the curriculum. We've always been pioneers. It's the frontiers that have changed.
You talk about having an even dose of running and passing, 75 yards rushing, 78 yards passing. Joe Gans gets the touchdown reception from Marlon Lucky, his third touchdown pass in a Nebraska uniform. Here it is again.
And this play is sold by Marlon Lucky. You see how he really sold the run there before he pulled up to throw it back. And you must have an athletic quarterback, and Joe Gans was just fast enough to get by the defender and create a little separation. How about that arm from Marlon Lucky? That was a tight spiral.
Not too shabby. Now Julius Fleming, a redshirt freshman out of Baton Rouge, Louisiana, joins Marcus Anderson to receive the kick, and Joe Gans all smiles.
He and Marlon over there chuckling a little bit. I can tell you, when you're out there practicing something all week, you just can't wait for the coaches to call a play like that. And when it comes into the huddle, oh boy. Nope. Butterflies start, because you know there could be just a chance for greatness on that play.
And the kick is going to be short. It's going to be Fleming, the redshirt freshman. Up to the 20, almost lost the handle. It gets up to the 24-yard line. Castile on the stop. You know, one of the things about that 3-3-5 defense, and talking to a couple of coaches over the last couple of days, they said, you've got to spread it out. And that's what they did on that play. It was obviously, you know, nobody was standing around to try to pick up on Gans. You can see the attendance, another crowd of over 84,000, 84,821. The NCAA record in sellouts.
This is a dangerous time for New Mexico State.
Absolutely.
Right now. Down 14-0. They really need to put a drive together.
Perez gets up to the 30-yard line. Pickup of 6 on the play. J.J. McDermott now the quarterback, the sophomore out of Katy, Texas, which is hopefully okay after the hurricane. It's just outside of Houston. They said he handles the backup job well, but when he comes in, Hal Mummy telling us, yeah, the playbook does kind of slim down a little bit, what playbook they have, I might add. But it does slim down a little bit, the options they give him as quarterback.
You just hope that he gets you in the right play and doesn't make a bad mental error.
He's scrambling for his life, and he's going to have to throw it away. He was outside the tackles. So that should not be intentional grounding. Now the officials may talk about it. He was outside the tackle. Potter was putting the pressure on him. Let's listen in.
Third down.
Well, it looked like he was outside the tackle box. And yet you have to get the ball back to the line of scrimmage, and I think he did that.
Yeah. And that's what our referee, Mr. Richens, just said. And Hal Mumme's squad facing third and four. Tough snap. McDermott hit as he throws. Pass is complete into Nebraska territory.
And
McDaniel on the reception.
Sorry, Ron, a nice route by McDaniel, finding a little hole in the middle of the field. McDermott knew he was going to get hit. Oh, yeah, a little stop and go right in the middle of the field. Got Phillip Dillard to bite on the stop. Nice route from McDaniel.
And it's a fresh set of downs. So McDermott doing a nice job. First and 10 from the 49. The quick look in. Pass off the fingertips of Williams. The freshman from Odessa, Texas. The last big game he played was for Odessa Permian. He's probably wondering, where'd you get all these 84,000 people? Here are the numbers for McDermott last year. He completed an outstanding percentage of his passes, over 60%. But he only had two touchdowns and four Oskies.
And he has a rocket of an arm. Watch the velocity he puts on the ball. When he has to, he can really unload it.
McDermott's quick pass to Fleming. Gets down to the 45-yard line. That'll set up about a third down and six situation. O'Hanlon doing an outstanding job again on the coverage.
You see a lot of teams doing this these days. If you're going to have DBs that are going to play off and you have a wide receiver that can throw a block for you, it's really just an extension of the running game at that point. It's like a toss sweep. You just get the ball out there, and you know it might not be a huge gain, but even if they make the tackle, you get five.
No word on what's wrong with Holbrook. Maybe they just decided to change up the pace. But it is third down and six. McDermott looking right. No, he just has the whistle blow. Hold on. And I think Nebraska called a timeout.
Timeout, Nebraska. Their second of the half.
So Nebraska with one timeout remaining, and we'll also step aside. 10:51 left to play in the opening half. Huskers lead it 14-0.
We're on a journey of discovery. A journey that is unlocking the secrets of disease at the genetic level. The result? Revolutionary cancer vaccines and research breakthroughs in Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease. And with every discovery, we provide new knowledge to thousands and new hope, one patient at a time. We've always been pioneers. It's the frontiers that have changed.
This is Nebraska, the home of champions. The nation's finest student athletes. Success in athletics, academics, and life. Nebraska, the power of red.
Just an absolutely gorgeous night in Lincoln, Nebraska. Crowd of 84,000 not only enjoying the weather, also enjoying the game as Nebraska leads it 14-0. Well, this is not a good sign. Pierre Allen is limping towards the locker room. Now the backup is Clayton Severs. He was backing up both defensive ends. Cameron Meredith, the freshman from Santa Ana, California, was expected to see playing time. Position they thought was deep. Not so much now.
That is one of the worst things that could have happened for this Nebraska defense right there, because after you have one go down, you go, okay, well, we can fill that spot. But you have two go down and you become really thin really fast. Clayton Severs is going to have to play a lot.
And McDermott on third and six. Here comes the pressure. Gets away from it. Takes a slide, but he will be short of the first down. Phillip Diller was ready to clock in with him. Zach Potter there. But he will be short, and now New Mexico State will be forced to kick it away. Dermott's making sure the elbow's there so that Ben don't break defense of Carl Pelini that time. Nate Swift standing back on his 10-yard line.
Tell you what, that's the luxury of being a head coach and coordinating the defense with your brother, Carl.
Yeah.
If you're Bo Pelini, you see something you don't like, it's a big third down, you call timeout.
That's exactly right.
And then you come back and you get in a position where you're able to make a play and you force them to punt it. So a good use of the timeout there if Bo felt like they were in a vulnerable situation on defense.
Well, New Mexico State just let the play clock go down. They're going to take the penalty, the delay of game. That'll back him up 4 yards. Hughes is set to kick it away. His first punt was 40 yards.
Ball. Delay of game offense. 5 yard penalty. Still fourth down.
And they'll try it again. Nate Swift coming into this game at 2 punt returns for 11 yards. He is standing back on his 10-yard line. Swift having an outstanding senior year out of Hutchinson, Minnesota. Nebraska shows and they back up, and the left footer gets a dandy of a kick away. Fair catch is called for right at the 10-yard line. That was something little that Swift did. A lot of people don't notice. He looked to see where people were, then he called the fair catch. Great job on that play.
Great ability to judge where the ball's going to come down and then refocus on the ball and have the ability to get under it and catch it.
Well, it's been a pretty good game so far for Marlon Lucky. In that first quarter, he was outstanding. Of course, he's got a rushing touchdown, a throwing touchdown, and you can see what he came in as far as the season numbers and what he's done tonight.
Having Leiden Murthaugh back has to help, although Murthaugh now on the sidelines for this drive. Javario Burke's in at right tackle.
You got to get him some playing time, and Roy Helu now into the lineup. He's got the ball, breaks into the secondary, up to the 25-yard line. Pickup of 14 on the play before Derek Richardson stopped him.
And Husker fans are loving this rushing game right now, let me tell you. Little frustration the last 2 weeks with the lack of productivity in the running game. One little cut back off the zone, blocking to the right side, and Helu with a little cut up the gut. A big gainer.
And another first down, 9.5 to play in the opening quarter. Helu will try it again. Another hole, making people miss as a penalty flag goes down, and I think Helu lost his shoe. Somebody did. There's a blown wheel back there. Oh, it's New Mexico State, but we do have a penalty flag.
Came from the back judge. Could be a holding penalty.
Face mask. Defense number 11. 15-yard penalty. Attack to the end of the line. Touchdown.
Once again, no incidental contact on the holding. It's a 15-yard or nothing.
See where it happens, right in the middle of the screen. You'll see it.
Right.
Right there. Just the illegal hands to the face on Mike McNeil, and that was Cotton, I believe, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was Cotton. So first down and 10, ball now on their own 47-yard line. Swift wide to the left, little play fake. Gans into the flat to Tifa Tiller, or to and a Tifa Tiller. He gets up over the 45, down to the 43-yard line. That'll be close to a first down. His first catch of the year. Nick Hayden on the stop.
Tifa Tiller back in the lineup. Finds himself out in the flat with a little opening. He's going to help add some experience.
Oh yeah.
And leadership to that. To that tight end core under Ron Brown. A couple young guys, Young and McNeil, playing all the first two games. Now they add Tifa Tiller to the mix.
Actually, Sean Watson actually coached his dad, his dad guy. Gans looking, dumps it off to Paul. He's upended, but not before he gets down to the 32-yard line. Vincent Butler on the stop.
Niles Paul lines up to the left of the formation, comes in a little motion, bootleg back to the right, and a little pitch and catch to Niles Paul from Joe Gans. Just a misdirection right there. Run a guy in motion, and if you're on defense, you see the fake to the outside run to the left, get everybody moving that way and come back to the right.
Couple of tight ends now for Nebraska. Helu following his blocks, bouncing off people as he gets inside the 30-yard line, out of the 29-yard line. Pickup of three on the play, but the sophomore from Danville, California had a breakout week last week.
Look at the feet, and for not being a big back, he's really tough to bring back. Look at the change of direction here and the strength to get into the end zone. Really has shown what he brings to the table early in this season.
And the numbers on him, and tonight, another 24 to his credit. Second down. Young in motion. We had a lot of people moving. Pick a player, any player.
I don't know if the offense was drawn off or the defense was drawn off by an offensive lineman.
All-star offense, number 72, 5-yard penalty, still second down.
62 or 52, either one. There's not one on here. I think he meant 72.
Javario Burks, possibly.
Bo doesn't like it. He's explaining his case. I think he's saying the defense are the ones who jumped him. Now Castile and Hello join each other in the backfield. Second down and 12 from the 34-yard line. Gans looks for the option. Already has a 20-plus run, and he's got another one. He's got Paydirt in mind. Touchdown, Nebraska! Yards, a career best for Joe Gans. He's caught a pass for a TD and he's run for a touchdown.
And that'll give a lot of confidence to this offense. Nebraska finding some success in the option game here tonight.
Henry remains perfect in a couple of years, kicking extra points. Over 220 yards offense already for the Huskers here in the opening half.
You'll see the great vision that Joe Gans shows on this play. Once he decides to go north and south, gets down the line of scrimmage, has his pitch man out there, Helu. And you see just the little gap getting upfield and then cutting back right there across the grain. And then the dive into the end zone, taking on the contact of Devon House.
You know, when you look at what they're doing running the football right now, I think you have to go to that 3-3-5 defense, because talking to some coaches today, one of them said what they try to do is screw up your blocking assignments. And one of the things that Sean Watson told us yesterday, we're not going to make this complicated as far as blocking assignments. And that 3-3-5, that opens up your guards just to shoot right at the linebackers. And if you hit it right, you have a chance for a big play.
Absolutely. It gives you the chance to hit a big one just about any time. They're just trying to really confuse everybody. And Joe Gans, once he finds this little seam to get upfield right there, and then the little cutback to the middle. And look, there's about seven defenders around him there as he goes into the end zone, but none of them were in the right position to make a play. Some of that is because in a 3-3-5, they're kind of roaming people around, and usually there's somewhat of a monster back who's usually a safety who kind of goes anywhere he wants and tries to just confuse the offense and confuse the quarterback. That time Nebraska caught them running the option into a defense that they weren't prepared to see an option play, and Joe Gans made them pay.
And what did Jolie Dunn tell us on Wednesday? We cannot let him get to the outside. I mean, that was the worst. We said, Coach, what is the worst case scenario? We cannot allow Joe Gans to get outside. And he's done it twice already tonight. In fact, Gans has three rushes for 64 yards. Not bad. 21 yards a carry. That'd work.
And 21 to nothing in a running game that's been impressive to this crowd here tonight. Nebraska fans are feeling pretty good.
133 yards rushing the football already tonight. Came in averaging just over 91 yards running. Another short kick. It's going to be Anderson from about the two. He gets to the outside, crosses the 30. They run him out of bounds at the 33-yard line, 32 yards on the return. Larry, what do you got on Pierre Allen? Is he going to be able to come back in?
Well, guys, this is potentially devastating news for this Husker defense. Pierre Allen has gone into the locker room for x-rays on his foot. I asked about a possible return, kind of got a wry smile and said very doubtful. You might notice now in the game with the defensive ends, Cameron Meredith as well as Clayton Seavers. These are the guys they're going to have to develop if something happened to Pierre.
Now, Cameron Meredith, the true freshman out of Santa Ana, California, very prestigious high school, and the coaches said he has already played in a very disciplined and high system. So they didn't have any worries about him coming in and playing.
No, and they really liked his maturity. You know, he went to modern day high school out there in California and played in a really structured defensive system out there. And so they felt like he was going to be able to absorb everything that it took to take the scheme in. And when they came to Cameron Meredith and said, hey, you know, would you want to play? Yeah. You know, are you ready to play? And he said, absolutely, I'm ready.
Well, you look at Clayton Severs there, the senior out of Elkhorn, Nebraska, and just watching him the last couple of years, Matt, I get the feeling that this is one of the blue-collar guys. This is the guy that just comes, brings his lunch pail, and the guys that Carl Pelini and Bo Pelini really like having on part of their team, some guy that they know they can count on, and he's just going to come and do the job.
Right, and he, you know, he's a Nebraska guy, blue-collar, like you said, and he's going to come every day to practice and really bring it. You know what you're going to get out of him, that great effort. Maybe a little bit of a drop-off in athleticism, which we talked about at the top, but Clayton Severs is going to play hard every single play he's out there on the football field.
Well, New Mexico State with 7:04 trailing in the second quarter, trailing 21-0. They take over first and 10 on their own 33-yard line. Chase Holbrook is back in the lineup, and Bo continues to plead his case on the far side of the field.
I don't know if I'd want to be the official
over
there on the Nebraska sideline.
Well, this is the officiating crew I was assigned to in July at the big officials conference, and I had to hang around these guys for 2 days. These guys take it very seriously, I can tell you that.
How do you get invited to all these things?
Everybody
I don't get invited to these things. You go down there, hang out with all the big wigs.
Yeah.
You've been around a few years longer than I have.
For the record, they didn't let us play golf at the Gaylord Resort, okay? At least they weren't going to pay for it. Let's put it that way. First and 10, Holbrook back into the lineup. Took a series off. They looked like they were moving the ball. The quick swing pass. Oh, my. I think Tony Glenn, he heard the footsteps of Nebraska's defense.
Lance Thorell was out there in coverage. I don't really know what the design of this play was supposed to be. Chase Holbrook just kind of lobs it out there. Lance Thorell was right there to make the play if Glenn had been able to catch it.
I think Lance was kind of getting a little snicker on his face, wasn't he? He thinks he had a free hit. Now they go from over center instead of the shotgun. Haven't seen that. Try the left side with Colston. The coaches, you mentioned it a few moments ago, Matt, were very concerned about their tackling, and Bo Pelini said that they took it on themselves as coaches to push them a little bit more.
Like I said, it's sometimes just asking them to do a better job, you know, and demanding in practice that they go out there and make it an emphasis, wrap up.
Oh, the quick pitch, incomplete. That was close to being a lateral. A.J. Harris, and Mukamara was right there. Harris was the intended receiver. I don't think anybody was set. That brings up a fourth down and 6, and we've got an Aggie down on the field.
Quick snap there by New Mexico State. Nebraska's defense not at all set. Luckily, Prince Amukamara was set and in position to be out there and make a play.
He closes quickly.
Even had the ball been caught, he wasn't going to get the first down, but a little trickery there from New Mexico State trying to catch Nebraska off guard.
Well, looks like center Richie Bolin. Now, this would be a huge loss because he's one of only two guys that had any kind of experience on that offensive line. Mike Grady is a redshirt freshman out of Corpus Christi, Texas. He is the backup. And Bolin is down. He has allowed only 3 sacks his entire career. And that's so important for Holbrook to quickly go off to the sideline and get underneath McGrady.
Well, and I'll tell you, having a senior center is important. I mean, he's really the captain of that offensive line. He's telling all the other younger offensive linemen who they have, what they need to do, what their assignment is on every play. So Bolin would be a huge loss if he's not able to return. You talk about the communication failures that Nebraska's had on their offensive line, much the same with New Mexico State and this young offensive line. They do have a senior right in the middle, so to lose him would be big.
Husker fans, catch Big 12 football on FSN all season long. FSN will televise 19 games live and in HD. on Big 12 Showcase. We preview the week's games, and on Saturdays throughout the fall, watch FSN's Big 12 postgame shows for all of the highlights. Plus, catch the Volpellini Show on Tuesdays at noon. Big 12 football this fall on FSN. FSN's Saturday morning shows, John Rattigan, former Oklahoma State coach Pat Jones, and Corby Jones, former quarterback of Missouri, do a great job. And he looks a little bit unsteady at that point. We hope to get an update on his position. Well, Niles Paul now standing on his 25-yard line. Set to receive the kick from Kyle Hughes, who's done a nice job punting the ball so far this evening. Let's see if Paul's got a punt return in his little bag of tricks. This is going to be a short kick. It looked like Hughes kind of did a little double take when he went to kick that ball. Hesitated a little bit.
Just off the side of his foot.
28 yards on the kick. His, by far, his worst effort of the evening. But the Huskers take over. Plenty of time left here in the opening half. Well, it's been the Joe Gann show, I think, along with Marlon Lucky. First, the halfback pass. Joe, don't drop it. I didn't. And then, of course, he runs the option for a touchdown. The swing pass to Peterson. Up over the 40, the 42-yard line. Betts on the coverage, the senior out of San Diego, California.
That play again, another one of those passing plays that's really an extension of the running game. In place of keeping the defense honest with the running game, you throw it out there, and you know you're going to get 4 to 6, 7 yards. If a guy makes a man miss, you could make it a bigger gainer.
Now there's only one defensive back past the 46-yard line. Here's Castile. Looks for a block, gets it. Nice job by Hunter Tiefenthaler with that block. That gave Castile a couple of more yards.
Quinn Castile now getting in there. You see the offensive lineman really getting out in front. Leighton Murthaugh leading the way. And then the patience from Quinton Castile, allowing the blocks to happen out in front of him with Tiefenthaler and then with Murthaugh out in front.
Murthaugh got two guys, I think, on that play, didn't he? He went to the next level. Marlon Lucky back in, along with Castile. First and 10. Gans looks for that option, trying to get that same side. This time the pitch was a little late. Lucky cannot get away. Forward progress, they're going to put him at about the 47-yard line, so that'll be a loss of about 3. Michael Zant, the true freshman, coming up to make the stop. His second tackle of the night.
Well, there's times when the option looks really good for a team that sometimes that doesn't run it a lot, and then there's times it doesn't really look good. And there,
somebody missed Joe the block Gans, right at the beginning.
Joe Gans just decides, well, there's really nothing out here. I'll let you have it. Hot potato.
Yeah. Not going to hurt my stats. Second down after the loss of 4, 14 to go. Gans, nice touch pass to Tiefenthaler. He crashes over the 40-yard line. Got a first down to the 38-yard line. His second reception of the night, Bayamonte, the linebacker on the stop.
Tiefenthaler, I think, is really going to add a lot to this offense. Experience. Watch him switch the ball twice in about 10 yards. He switches it right arm to left arm, then back to the right arm.
First game, didn't play the first two. Has looked good tonight. On first and 10, Castile, right side. Oh, he slips a tackle inside the 30 down to the 28-yard line. I tell you, the backs are feeling it tonight, Matt Bob.
When you have three guys to run in there, you're always fresh, and Castile doesn't mind contact. So he doesn't mind going up the middle, but if he has to pop it outside, he could do that as well. He's really versatile.
Now Mike Caputo now in at center. Jacob Hickman getting a breather, the redshirt freshman out of Omaha, Nebraska. Second down and very, very short. It's a free down. Gans looks, swings it out, overthrows Castile. Gans,
Castile, incomplete. pressure that time from New Mexico State. Joe Gans had to get rid of it quick, and he kind of had to guess as to how far Castillo was going to get out there. And just overthrew him by a couple of yards. Now a third and short, and this is where you have to be able to line it up and mow somebody over.
This is what I think all of us expected last week. Isn't it against San Jose State?
I think so. And San Jose State did a really good job. And I think it's a combination of Nebraska being better this week and San Jose State maybe being a little bit better than New Mexico State defensively.
Three tight ends in, opens a hole. Castile bounces off a couple, able to get inside the 20 down to the 18-yard line. Derek Richardson finally brought him down, but watch the strength of Castile, the sophomore out of La Porte, Texas.
Well, would you want to tackle this guy? Watch him lower the boom here. Bam! Just pretty much runs him over. Lower the pad level there. Lower the shoulders, take on the hit, and get about 8 yards after contact.
Marvin Betts giving up 50 pounds to Castile on that play, and it showed. On first and 10, Castile again. Gets to the outside, inside the five, and he comes up short. They'll mark him out at about the 1 yard line. Now they're going to put it back now to the 3 yard line.
The left side of the offensive line here did a great job. Javario Burks gets that width out there and gets just enough of his man, then gets to the second level. Allows Castile to get out around it to the sidelines, and he's not going to go out of bounds.
No,
I'll tell you that.
No.
He stepped out there, but that was on accident. He's not going to. He's not going to shy away from contact.
Now Tifa Tiller lines up in the fullback spot. He's an outstanding lead blocker. This time, nothing doing. Jason Scott, the junior out of Chino Hills, California, on the stop. I think when we're seeing Tifa Tiller, we've seen McNeil, we've seen Young, we've seen a lot of the tight ends. They had such a great game against Western Michigan. They did not play well last week against San Jose State. Tonight we're seeing them playing at the level we saw them a couple of weeks ago.
Well, Ron Brown was a little disappointed, I think, in the play of his tight ends, and he takes that personally, I can tell you. And he went back this week, and he demanded that they put in the time and effort to make themselves better this week. And he went in and talked to Sean Watson. Ron Brown said, hey, you know, I'm sorry. We'll be better this week. And they are better this week.
Well, you played under Coach Brown, and you know how aggressive he is. And he expects blocking. He expects the little things to be done on and off the football field. And I think that's translating tonight. Ron, truly one of the outstanding not only coaches but human beings. You see him at the bottom of your screen there with a headset on.
Just a great addition to the staff, and Coach Brown could have easily left Nebraska when things fell apart here 4 years ago. He stuck around, worked with the Fellowship of Christian Athletes, does so many great things around the state of Nebraska and around the country. Mm-hmm. Tremendous public speaker. It was my privilege to sit in his meeting room every day for 4 years, I can tell you that.
But there's one problem with Ron. He's never put on an ounce of body fat in the 10 or 15 years I've known him.
He's the eldest member of the staff, but he looks like he's about 24.
Yeah, exactly. Second down and goal to go. It's inside the five, and we want to send our best to Ron Brown's wife, whose father is extremely ill out in California. And our thoughts and prayers, obviously, are with you. And we checked with Coach Brown yesterday, and it's weighed heavily on him. But because of his faith, he's standing tall.
Well, no group of players on this team will play harder than the kids that play for him. Those tight ends will work their tails off every day. Because he demands it, and you know what? Because they want to, for him.
Absolutely. Third down and goal, it's on the 4 yard line. Helen is going to be stopped short again. Derek Richardson doing a nice job stopping the run. So Nebraska was knocking on the door, and they can't punch it in.
Nebraska trying to impose their will right here on New Mexico State, and really they did a good job there. I was expecting a pass on that down. I think Nebraska thought New Mexico State would expect a pass, and instead they try to hammer it right at them.
Well, Nebraska gets a minor advantage here because they were going to have to call a timeout. They're probably going to go for it, but a New Mexico State player, Brennan Bayamonte, He's favoring, obviously, that left leg. He has to go off. But on fourth down, ball sitting on the 3-yard line, the Huskers will go for it. Okay. Coach Davison, what do you call? Do you run that option again? They've liked that left side.
I run a bootleg with Joe Gans. Get him out of the pocket. Let him have the option of running or passing the ball.
Mike McNeil is the tight end on the left side. Tifa Tiller in the backfield. Hello behind him. They run the option. Gans. Oh, my goodness. He's going to be dragged down by Jason Scott at the 3-yard line. A nice defensive play by the junior.
How about that? Nebraska runs four running plays in a row when they get inside the 10-yard line. And I like that confidence and you know, the ability to call those plays and try to just run it right in against a team that you should probably be able to run it right in against.
Well, they had 172 yards rushing prior to that play. And now let's see if the defense can make something happen. Final minute and 6 seconds. Or will Hal Mummy just kind of say, wait a minute, guys, we're on the 4-yard line. Let's not do anything dumb here. Holbrook goes over center again. Second time that's happened. They run it with Colston. He's able to scamper his way up to about the 15-yard line of first down. Murillo chases him out of bounds.
I'm surprised at the number of running attempts New Mexico State has attempted already. 13 here in the first half. Didn't think that ratio would be near what it is. 19 pass attempts, 13 run attempts. But they're shortening the game that way.
That's exactly right. They were 109th in the country in rushing last year. Holbrook, the quick pass to the outside to Williams. Murillo's the one who runs him out of bounds. 55 seconds left in the half. Holbrook's got a little bit of breathing room now. Played all but one game last year, Holbrook did. Two straight years, over 33,000 yards passing. If he does it again this season, it'll be an NCAA record. A little stop by Colston, and he is going to be swarmed over by the Nebraska defense. That'll bring up a third down and about two. Dominican Sue on the stop. First time we called his name tonight.
Sue, another one of those D linemen that trimmed up a little bit, but is just a bolt inside. I mean, he is so strong.
Oh, yeah. Each team with a timeout. Final 30 seconds. Floating the pass to the sideline. Complete to A.J. Harris. Was that blown coverage? Because O'Hanlon tried to cover it up from the safety spot.
It had to be. He was wide open on third and short.
First and 10 from the 39-yard
line. Down here at the bottom of the screen.
Yeah.
Prince Amukamara jumps the underneath route. And O'Hanlon late over the top. Good job by Holbrook, really just seeing that hole and throwing it out there.
25 seconds left to play in the half. No pressure. Now here it comes. Holbrook loses the football. New Mexico State will have it. And Dominican Sue is the one who got the hand on it. That pocket started to collapse quickly.
Chase Holbrook tries to step up into the pocket. You'll see Sue come from the right side. Does a great job of just knocking it out. Big old right paw. Rips it out of there.
And that'll be the last play of the opening half. So the Huskers and the Aggies, they both missed field goals on their opening drives, but then the Huskers answer with 21 points. They've got 292 total yards, 163 for New Mexico State. A good all-around effort by both the Nebraska offense and the defense, especially rushing the football. The Huskers, 172 yards rushing. Let's send it down to Larry with Coach Bo.
Well, Coach, you wanted the defense to play with more urgency this game. Are you getting that?
Yeah, I think so. We started slow. We made a couple mistakes early. They kind of gave us a couple formations that we weren't quite ready for, but that we hadn't talked about. But we adjusted well, and the kids are playing hard, and I like what I'm seeing.
You, Pierre Allen, any update?
he's okay. The X-rays are negative, but he's just he's got some soft tissue, you know, some soft tissue damage in there. We're trying to figure out if we can tape it up and see if he can come back.
Thanks, Mo.
Thank you, guys.
Coach Pelini heads to the locker room. His team is up 21-0. Second half activities coming up from Lincoln, Nebraska. And pretty good first half for the Huskers. Under the light of a full moon, they lead it over to Mexico State 21-0. Along with Matt Davison, I'm Ron Thulin. In the open, we talked about the defense and how the defensive line has taken it to a new level. We saw New Mexico State move the ball, but they didn't give up any points. You have to credit that defensive line.
Well, once again, it comes down to up front. How tough are you? And Nebraska was really tough again. Even though they gave up some rushing yards early on in the first half, once again, when teams get in the red zone, they really stiffen up. And Nebraska, as you know, up 21-0 right now, and partly because of that blocked field goal by Zach Potter. So once again, it's been the defense stepping up again this week. Armando Murillo with the big pick and run back inside New Mexico State's territory. So right now, Nebraska's defense playing well. I think Husker fans feeling pretty good about things right now.
And they were worried about it because this offense is so unpredictable. You heard Bo telling Larry, we saw some formations we didn't expect to see. Once again, the key word, adjustments.
Well, they go over to the sidelines after the first couple series when New Mexico State did have some success, and then all of a sudden they were just shut down. So Bo and Carl Pelini over there on the sidelines talking to their guys, really able to adjust there in that second quarter and come out and shut down New Mexico State. One of the big adjustments in the first half, I think, was how they lined up their defensive line and how they were able to attack Chase Holbrook and not allow him to stand back there in the pocket and pick them apart.
Now, there's still plenty of football left to be played. When we come back, we'll give you the highlights and the numbers from the first 30 minutes. But the Huskers lead it by 3 touchdowns.
This is Nebraska, the home of champions, the nation's finest student athletes, success in athletics, academics, and life. Nebraska, the power of red.
The International Quilt Studies Center and Museum weaves together history and artistry. With thousands of quilts from dozens of countries, the Quilt Center houses the finest public collection in the world. World-class collections. That's the power of red.
Honor the past and invest in the future by contributing to the new Nebraska Student Life Complex. Located on the west side of Memorial Stadium, the Student Life Complex will nearly triple the size of Nebraska's Hewitt Center for Student Athletes, providing current and future Huskers more space, resources, and technology to continue Nebraska's rich academic tradition. For more information, go to Huskers.com.
Minutes of football left to be played. Nebraska leads it 21-0. It has been a well-played game, both sides of the football for the Huskers. Along with Matt Davison, I'm Ron Thulin. Let's take a look at the numbers from the first 30 minutes. And I think the one that stands out, obviously, if you're a Nebraska fan, is 172 yards rushing.
Well, and that's what Nebraska fans really wanted to see here today, was whether or not Nebraska could control the line of scrimmage up front. Having Leiden Murthaw back on that right side with Matt Slauson really made a big difference. Nebraska almost 300 yards total offense in the first half. And then they forced a turnover, too, with Armando Murillo, which is something Bo Pelini is always talking to his team about, is trying to force those turnovers. So I think overall you have to be happy right now if you're a Nebraska fan.
And only 2 penalties after last week. Now, some of the highlights of the game. It didn't start out all that well for the Huskers because New Mexico State missed a field goal. And then it appeared as though Nebraska would, well, they had theirs blocked. And then Nebraska was in position to keep their record perfect from field goals.
And then Alex Henry, who hasn't missed in 2 years, steps up and he misses wide right. So a couple of opportunities blown. But Nebraska was able to bounce right back. Marlon Lucky's able to get in there to the end zone. We talk a lot, Ron, about how there's a few plays in each game that really change momentum. This was one of them right here on the halfback pass. They pitch it to Marlon Lucky. He throws it back to the quarterback, Joe Gans. That really gave Nebraska momentum. And then Joe Gans was really effective on the ground in the first half. Nebraska running more option than we've seen in the first two games of the season. Joe Gans running it in for 33 yards there, the longest run of his career.
Well, of course, Nebraska did have first and goal from the four-yard line. We're not able to put it in. So at least the coaches have something to talk about tomorrow.
Well, that's right. They're going to go in there and say, guys, four-yard line? I mean, can't we stuff it in against New Mexico State? That guy right there, Bo Pelini, he's going to have them ready to go in the second half. I'll guarantee you that.
Well, Bo Pelini has them ready to go for the second half, and that is forthcoming. We'll step aside. Be back in a moment.
Fans, don't miss your chance to be part of the action at the Devaney Center this fall.
Go! A bottle of time by Dawkins Arrow. Highlight reel.
2008-2009 Nebraska men's basketball season ticket packages are on sale now and start at only $99. To get your tickets, visit Huskers.com or call 1-800-8-BIG-RED. Nebraska basketball. Play hard as one. Cheer hard as one.
Now on Real Nebraska, how does it feel to be a Husker?
Awesome! Oh my God.
I'm freaking out right now. I don't know.
It's all about Nebraska.
It's the power of red.
This is Nebraska. The home of champions. The nation's finest student athletes. Success in athletics, academics, and life. Nebraska, the power of red.
Second half set to get underway. Nebraska will be receiving the second half kickoff. You know, we talked about the quarterbacks at the top of the show, the couple of number 12s there. Chase Holbrook, of course, on the left. Joe Gans on the right. Chase Holbrook taken out for a series. We still can't figure out exactly why he was taken out, unless they just wanted to get McDermott a little playing time. But here are the numbers so far. And I think the key right now is just 88 yards, no touchdowns for Holbrook.
Well, New Mexico State has run the ball more than I thought they would in this game already, with 13 running attempts. And Joe Gans on the offensive side for Nebraska, I just like the balance that they've had. 9 of 13, 100 yards and a touchdown in the air. That is super efficient, especially when you already have 170 yards on the ground. So great balance from Nebraska's offense.
Alfonso Dennard is back for Nebraska. Dennard, the freshman out of Rochelle, Georgia. Rochelle, Georgia, you think they would be Bulldog fans. Rochelle, Georgia, a town of about 1,000, have now become the official Huskerville of Georgia. They said he got a couple of gas stations there. He was a do-everything young man for the high school. Played quarterback, running back, wide receiver, DB, linebacker. He punted, and he kicked.
That's it?
That's it. He didn't play the tuba in the band, but everybody there is so proud of Dennard, who celebrated his 19th birthday this past Tuesday.
Watch him. He'll be the guy blocking right here for Niles Paul.
And he blocked last week when Paul took one to the house. Paul this time skips over the 20 to the 22-yard line. That's where Nebraska will take over. Larry, what do you have for us, buddy?
Well, I talked with Coach Mummy coming out of the halftime, and he said, you know, the decision to go with J.J. McDermott for a couple of series over Holbrook was really a planned deal. They did it for two series, took in their entire second-team offense. He liked what he saw out of them, so they just couldn't execute late. And a lot of the troubles, he says, are first-game type things. They're one player away here and there. Injury report very quickly. Richie Bolin possibly out for the game, negative on an X-ray to his rib. It's not broken, but doubtful that Richie Bolin will return.
All right. Thank you, Larry. Don't forget, this is New Mexico State's first game of the year. This is out to Peterson, maybe picked up a yard or two. I think if you put that in perspective, that Nebraska has played two games, and as you mentioned, you try to improve first, second game. Hal Mumme's got to be pleased with that first 30 minutes of football.
I don't think he can be that disappointed. They very easily could have scored a touchdown on their first drive of the game. They marched right down the field. Didn't seem to have first game jitters there. Then they get a field goal blocked. And the rest of the way, you know, it's 21 to nothing, but you know, honestly, not that they didn't believe that they were going to come in here and win, but, you know, that was a pretty competitive first half, really, just a handful of plays that changed the game.
Well, Brennan Bayamonte is down again. That's the second time he went down. First time he limped off, and they were working on the left leg. Now it looks like the right leg. Well, Nebraska was very efficient with their possessions in that opening half, Matt.
13 plays, 73 yards. Even though you miss a field goal, that's a good drive right there. Ball control, 6 for 58, 1 for 20. You'll take that. And that was right off the interception return by Armando Murillo. So touchdown, touchdown, touchdown right in the middle of the first half. You like that. And offensive coordinator Sean Watson has to like what he sees right now from his offensive line. They are the aggressors up front. Those big bulls really paving the way for these running backs here tonight.
You know, I've had a chance to know Sean since his days at Colorado, and even though, you know, he was taking a little criticism about the run game, I can honestly say he's never changed in the 8 years I've known the guy, and he's not going to.
Well, a great character coach. And,
absolutely.
And he's going to do what he knows is right, and he's not going to let anybody else is saying affect what he's doing.
Second down and 8. Here's Lucky. Finds a hole. First down. To the 25, to the 20, knocked out of bounds at about the 17-yard line.
This is what Husker fans expected to see out of Marlon Lucky when he was recruited 3 years ago. Number 2 running back coming out of Hollywood, California, and he gets into the open field and shows that tremendous burst and a big gainer for Nebraska's offense.
60 yards on the carry for Marlon Lucky. He never really lost steam. It was just good pursuit by Joe Lee Dunn's defense. Now the officials are talking at about the 17-yard line over something.
I don't know what it could be, but I can tell you as an offense, you want to get back over the football because all those defenders were just chasing 60 yards downfield. They're winded. You want to get over the ball and snap it again and get after them.
Well, they're yelling out something to Bo. I think one of the officials may be hurt. That's what it looks like to me right now, is one of the officials may have pulled up. Because they're talking to one of the linesmen, the line judge, David Oliver. And that's what they're doing. David Oliver, the linesman, is being looked at by the trainers for the Nebraska Cornhuskers.
Left knee, I think, is what maybe they were looking at, lower left leg. They do have substitute officials at the game in case there is a guy that goes out with a bad wheel.
I think the officials are going to call an official timeout. Yes, they are. So Carl Richens, the referee, calls the timeout as David Oliver goes into the sideline. We'll be back.
We're on a journey of discovery, a journey that is unlocking the secrets of disease at the genetic level. The result? Revolutionary cancer vaccines and research breakthroughs in Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease. And with every discovery, we provide new knowledge to thousands and new hope, one patient at a time. We've always been pioneers. It's the frontiers that have changed.
This is Nebraska, the home of champions. The nation's finest student athletes. Success in athletics, academics, and life. Nebraska, the power of red.
Nebraska moving again, and they already lead it 21 to nothing. Husker fans, catch Big 12 football on FSN all season long. FSN will televise 19 games live and in HD on Big 12 Showcase. We preview the week's games. And on Saturdays throughout the fall, watch FSN's Big 12 postgame shows for all the highlights. Plus, catch the Bo Pelini Show Tuesdays at noon. Big 12 football this fall on FSN. Marlon Lucky now has 98 yards rushing. He now has over 2,000 rushing yards for his career, the 24th in Husker history to achieve that goal. He's also moved from 6th to 4th in career all-purpose yardage, passing a guy named Eric Crouch and Corey Ross. Not bad company there, huh?
Yeah, that's pretty good.
And we'll try to get an update on the linesman, Oliver, in a little bit. Gans fakes left, goes right, throws it to Lucky. He's got a blocker in front of him. Cuts back inside the 5 down to the 4. Guess who was blocking in front of him? Big 76.
Leiden Murtha has been big in this game today. And I think when we go back and watch this film, you're going to see that he has brought a lot to this offense. You see him there at right tackle. He blocks down, then gets right out in front of Marlon Lucky. And that is a big human being out there. I wouldn't mind running behind him
either. No, I'd hide behind him.
The amazing thing about Murtha, as big as he is that he runs a 4.7 at 6'7", 315.
That's
not bad.
Huge. Lucky, left side, gets close, not close enough. That'll bring up a second down and goal. Just about 2 minutes gone by here in the second quarter. Well, that's a good sign. Pierre Allen probably thought, wait a minute, coach, I'm kind of dinged up here. You sure you want me to sit on this bike? Keeping him loose, though, but that's a good sign.
Keeping him warm, and another guy right behind him there, number 3, Ricky Tenars. Nebraska's defense will be happy to get him back as well one of these days.
Hurt his shoulder against Western Michigan. Didn't play in the game last week. Second down and goal. Lucky. Looking, pushing, shoving his way. They're going to mark it right in front of the goal line. Joe Gans was putting his hands up. He thought he had it.
Big push up front from that offensive line. Marlon Lucky trying to sneak in there. Mike Huff pulled from the left guard position. You see Ryan Hill trying to push him forward. Now 100 yards rushing for Marlon Lucky.
And here we go. Third down and goal. Less than a yard. Lucky again. Touchdown, Nebraska.
And nice to see Marlon Lucky, if you're a Husker fan, really breaking out today. The offensive line getting a better push. And these are the touchdowns you like to have. Really untouched going across the goal line. And then he celebrates with his teammates. Over 100 yards and a couple of touchdowns for Marlon Lucky tonight.
And he had only 66 yards and 2 touchdowns coming into the game. And another Aggie is being helped off the field. Michael Zant, the true freshman out of Midland, Texas. So they've had a number of players that have gotten dinged up tonight. Henry trying to keep his record perfect for point afters. And he is 4 for 4 tonight, 9 for 9 for the season. 59 of 59 in his career. We're going to take a break. Marlon Lucky, his second touchdown of the night.
Well, you know, I didn't really do a lot of cheerleading. And I was usually on the sideline with headphones. And I was really pretty deep in thought, and but I would like to leave you with this, and that is, go Big Red.
Who has the power to harness energy? University of Nebraska-Lincoln research finds answers to global problems. With leading-edge science, we explore renewable energy, reduce the impact of drought, conserve and protect our natural resources. It's clear, the University of Nebraska-Lincoln helps keep the planet green. Now that's the power of red.
Nebraska with 368 total yards. They lead it 28-0. Larry, how about an update on the linesman that was hurt in this ball game? Well, Larry was getting a further update from one of the officials on the sideline. And here's where the official got hurt. Watch the bottom of your screen. He's trailing, and right there. Larry, what do you got for us? How is he? How's Oliver?
Well, Oliver will be out for the game with his strained calf, guys. They are going to go with six officials. And, Matt, your question about, you know, don't they have an alternate? They do. But here's an oddity. The alternate is not sanctioned to officiate in this game. So they're going with six officials for the rest of the way.
Why was he the alternate then?
Yeah, why was he the alternate then? I think Matt has sanctioning power. So.
I can go down there.
I'll let you ask that question, Matt.
Marcus Anderson is back along with Julius Fleming, and this is going to be Fleming. Another short kick, though, for the Huskers. And he gets up to the 28-yard line. There's not much wind, although if there is a wind, they're kicking into it if they go from south to north. But still, a couple of short kickoffs, not good. And we do have you can see the wind has picked up a little bit, but it's been so good the first couple of games, Matt, and as far as getting it into the end zone.
Yeah, there hasn't been a lot. And when it's blowing just that much, five or six stories up, down on the field, it's not going to be blowing much. There's Pierre Allen still trying to get it loose. You know, in a 28-0 game, I don't know if you want to bring him back.
I wouldn't either, yeah. And it's going to be Neiman. He is surrounded by a bunch of red jerseys, and he will finally run out at about the 39.5, and they'll mark it at the 40-yard line. Good enough for a first down, though. Lance Terrell coming up, getting some playing time. Didn't see a whole lot the first couple of games.
A nice run by Neiman out in the open field. Terrell had a chance to make a play and really needs to force him back to the inside. If you're going to get beat, just dropped him in a bucket and ran out there and got a first down.
He was a wide receiver and a quarterback in high school. So he does have some running ability. Holbrook now going deep down the middle, has a man knocked away at the last second. Eric Haig had to turn around. The pass was intended for Anderson, but Anderson had a couple of steps on him, it looked.
He did. Chase Holbrook underthrew him. Just finding the slot receiver going right down the middle of the post. And this ball's just underthrown. Haig was beat deep.
Yeah.
And Anderson is not happy.
And now Tony Glenn in the backfield as Holbrook will take it from under center. Glenn bounces to the right side. Penalty flag is thrown as he gets to the 48-yard line before Haig again brings him down. Pickup of 8 on the play.
Holding offense number 65. 10-yard penalty.
The
2 second down.
Polo Gutierrez, the right guard, is the culprit.
And that will hurt your offense on the road. Left side of the screen, 65, just with a little hold. I don't know how much it even affected the play. Those are the ones you just can't stand.
Yeah. Because I wasn't even in the play. Hell, Mummy. And New Mexico, only 1-8 since the BCS was formed against the BCS school in 98. Only BCS win was when they beat number 22 Arizona State. Second down in the bundle. And it has gotten loud. They show the blitz, a little swing pass to Colston. And he's able to get up to the 35-yard line. That'll bring up a third down and about 15.
We talked about how Chase Holbrook has a lot of ability at the line of scrimmage to change the play. Look at it here, communicating verbally and with hand signals, telling everybody who you've got him. This is what we're going to do against this look. Communication, always a big key to things, and a lot of times fans can't see that, but there's a lot going on with hand signals and through verbal communication.
Third down, New Mexico State, 5 of 9. They've had some success tonight. Holbrook looking, and he may go down, gets it away. Nice defensive play by Nebraska's Murillo. And Hal Mummy wanted a over the back. He is livid on the sideline. Clayton Severs is the one who put the pressure. Good job just getting this ball away.
Yeah, Holbrook showed his strength there. Severs hanging all over him. He still has the ability to put quite a bit of torque on that ball. Gets it out there. Now Mummy is incensed right now, throwing his towel around.
I thought it was a good defensive play, to be honest with you, as Kyle Hughes set to kick it away to Niles Paul, standing at his own 25-yard line. I thought it was just a salty play. This time Hughes takes about 3 steps to kick it, and again, he shanks it off the side of his foot. Instead of being a one-step kicker, he looked like he took 3, and that's just a 30-yard kick after a 28-yarder, his last attempt. And he's met by the coach right when he comes off the field.
Yeah, need to get a little bit more out of your special teams than that.
Yeah. What a night for Marlon Lucky, though. You can see the numbers. As far as the season numbers and the average tonight, a lot better.
I think that's what people expected from Marlon Lucky coming into the season.
Karinsky Gillian now in the lineup. Gans rolling out, pump fakes, has some running room. Nice cutback. Takes a wallop as he gets to the 40-yard line. Pickup of 4 on the play. I thought he was going to get a little more than that.
It looked like it. Tell you what, when you go against the grain like that, there is times you can just get your head knocked off. He's looking for Nathan Swift out in the flat. Cuts up field, does a good job. There's the defensive lineman coming back the other direction, and he got sandwiched a little bit there. Joe Gann's a tough guy.
Second down and 4 from the 42-yard line. Lucky is stacked up. Oh, my. That looked like a face mask, and a penalty flag from the field judge comes flying in, as it should have.
And that should be 15 yards and get Nebraska into New Mexico State territory.
Third down.
Wow.
Oh my. Didn't expect that. Just grabbed the helmet.
You know what?
That should be a horse collar there. Joining us in the booth is somebody very familiar to Nebraska fans, and of course, he made Matt Davison what he is today. Former quarterback Scott Frost, now co-defensive coordinator at Northern Iowa. Scott, good to have you with us today.
Hey, I appreciate it. It's a good game to be watching.
And Joe Gann swings it out. Nice move. Lucky tries to cut it back on third down. Maybe picked up a yard on the play. Derek Richardson on the stop. Okay, did you make him good or did he make you look good?
As far as I know, he only ever made one play, and I threw that one. So.
Well,
I'm still trying to decide who got more out of that play in Missouri between you or me.
And here's a couple of highlights here. See, he always talks about how he made you look good. I don't know what that is. I'd let you two guys fight that one.
Hey, I was just a glorified lineman out there most of the time blocking for him.
But a good one at that. So Nebraska is going to be forced to kick it away on fourth down. Chris Williams is back. It's the first punt of the ball game, and Williams kicks the line drive, loses it, and goes down immediately at the 17-yard line. Prince Amukamara on the stop. Nice job. 44 yards on the kick.
A little fumble by Chris Williams, and Amukamara, if he was there a split second earlier, he would have been able to jump on that baby. Nonetheless, good punt coverage there for Amukamara.
Hey, Scott, now that you're a coach, do you look at games differently than when you played?
Yeah, I do. I got to tell you, I'm pretty impressed with Nebraska today. I like what they're doing. They're running the ball, and they're more physical than New Mexico State, and I'm glad to see that.
Are you going to start picking Carl and Bo's brain?
Yeah, I'd love to get in that meeting room with them and come up with a few new ideas.
Well, they put the ball on the ground. Colson couldn't hold on to it. They only fumbled 17 times last year, only lost seven of them. That's because they didn't run the ball a whole lot. Your impressions of the defense, what Bo's doing, though, number one, getting guys more flexible. How does that help?
Well, I tell you, they really had a challenge today with all the things that New Mexico State was running. I think they did a good job adjusting after that first series. So they look good to me. They're tackling well and playing aggressive.
Second down and 13, ball sitting on the 15-yard line. They'll keep it on the ground, trying the left side, nothing doing. That'll bring up a third down and about 11.
Scott, you went out to Stanford originally out of high school and tried defense for a little bit, then offense, then came back here, played quarterback. We all know what you did in Nebraska. But now you're defensive coach, co-defensive coordinator at Northern Iowa. How did playing offense allow you to transition to defense? I mean, obviously you played in the NFL on defense as well, but how did you end up on the defensive side?
Oh, you know, just playing defense in the NFL, I think, led me to that. And then the guy that got me into coaching, Raheem Morris at the Buccaneers, is a defensive coach, and I learned a lot from him and Mike Tomlin down there. And just, you know, actually, I really value the fact that I've been on both sides of the ball. Just gives me a little more understanding of what the other side's trying to do.
Colson can't get the little swing pass from Holbrook, who was on the money, and they're getting a little frustrated, I think, offensively with 6:38 left to play in the third. They're going to have to kick it away again.
Bunch of guys back for the Hall of Fame induction, so I'm sure you've been down on the sidelines talking with former teammates, guys that you've met over the years. You're coaching now, so you don't get to come back a lot. Talk about what it's like to be back in the stadium and hear those cheers again.
I'm just fired up to be back here. It's great to have it be an atmosphere we can all come back to again, and everybody's fired up. I saw Jared Tomich down there and Grant and some guys that I want to see if they still have any years of eligibility to come play for me. They're still huge.
Yeah, we've got a whistle, and the play clock goes down to zero, and another delay of game. Now that's going to back them up. Nate Swift is standing on the 50-yard line. If you're Nebraska, okay, we'll go Coach Frost on this. If you're Nebraska, do you go after this or just accept a great field position?
I think they just try to get a return here and see if they can get some field position, get another score.
Now Mummy looking a tad frustrated right now. His team is down 28-0. Good snap. Nebraska backs off. Hughes a little bit better kick. This will take a bounce at about the 40-yard line, and that's where they're going to mark it dead, and that's where the Huskers will take over. Well, we're glad to have Scott Frost with us, along with his former teammate Matt Davidson. I'm Ron Thulin, and just coming back and seeing this whole rejuvenation, because it's been a very difficult time, obviously, the last few years for former players and for fans. What differences have you seen that have really stood out to you?
I think they did a great job setting up this stadium. The atmosphere in here is unbelievable. You forget when you're not around here. But the program's back in the right hands. You know, I know how much Tom cares about this, and he's one of the best people I've ever met. So I'm just really excited for the direction everything's going.
He's like smiling like a Cheshire cat over here for some reason. I have no clue why. I was afraid to ask, to be honest with you. As Nebraska keeps it on the right side, picking up a couple of yards. Okay, Matt, you can ask whatever you want. Now's your chance, buddy. You've had probably, 10 years you've been waiting for this moment.
Well, I'll tell you what, I wanted to congratulate you. I don't know if you saw there was a new publication out today, and they had the top 25 Nebraska football players of the last 25 years for Nebraska football, and you made the top 25 players. Did you see this magazine?
No, I didn't see it.
Well, there it is. And you made the top 25 players in the last 25 years. And there's another guy on there. Well, there you are, number 20. Number 20 greatest player in the last 25 years for Nebraska football.
At least you got a picture, because number 14 didn't get a picture. Okay,
well,
just for the record,
they obviously
right?
didn't rank them by looks. That, you know, that's also why there's no picture on number 14.
Well, you can autograph this if you want it to my dear friend Matt, if you want. Love always. I mean, this is your copy.
Hey, I appreciate that.
Yeah, I noticed how he grabbed it. Okay, we'll file that. Hey, Scott, we appreciate you spending
Thank
time
you very
with
much.
Us today. Good to have you back. Good luck, Northern Iowa. I'm sure we're going to be talking about you one of these days.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
All right.
Thanks, Scott.
Hey, good to see you.
That was heartfelt. As the Huskers keep it on the ground. 5.5 minutes to play in quarter number 3. Ball will be on the 35-yard line. Fresh set of downs for Nebraska. Scott Frost, truly one of the nice guys for coming up and spending some time with us. It was good to have him up here, though. I was glad to have him up here.
Everybody that we've interviewed tonight, Ron, were seniors when I was a freshman. Lowly little freshmen. I have Scott Frost, I have Jason Peter, Grant Wistrom, all seniors. And let me tell you, they made it rough on us sometimes, but it made us better, that's for
sure.
That's
exactly right. That's what they're there for. On first down, Joe rolling out to his right, looking, throws across his body, caught McNeil. Inside the 10, inside the 5, touchdown, Nebraska! Joe Gans becomes the first Husker to pass and to catch a touchdown since Eric Crouch versus Cal in 1999 and throw one.
Three different ways to score a touchdown, and I was in that game against California right here in Memorial Stadium. Eric Crouch caught one, threw one, and rushed for one, and I think they're going to review this.
Now the replay booth has called into the truck. They want to take a look at this again.
Well, you'll see the bootleg action from Joe Gans. This is where he's at his best. On the run, he finds Mike McNeil, and you won't see a more athletic play than this right here. Look at that. Whoop. Around him, gets up the sideline, tries to jump over the defender, and I think that's going to be a touchdown. The ball came out when he hit the ground. We'll see here, but I think the ball breaks the plane of the goal line. He comes down.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
I think he had possession when the ball went across the goal line, and then it came out as he hit the ground. That I don't think can be overturned, and that's a nice play for Mike McNeil. It's amazing what a play like that will do for your confidence, a young guy making a play out in the open field like that.
First career touchdown was versus Western Michigan, a three-yarder. He's caught a 32-yarder and a 35-yarder. Talking to the coaches about Mike McNeil, the sophomore out of Kirkwood, Missouri, they said, this guy's got good receiving skills, and we've seen it tonight. Good running skills, too. Let's look at it again.
And how about the block? Niles Paul right there, bam. Just frees him enough to get him up the sidelines. And I'll tell you, as a receiver, when you get that close to the goal line, that's a picture right there Mike McNeil will have on his wall someday. Look at that. Straight up and down. Might have cracked his back a little bit when he came down. That's an athletic play right there for a big man.
It is a touchdown. So McNeil with his second career touchdown. It covered 35 yards, and the Huskers add more to it. You know, and this has just been a good showing by the tight ends. We talked about at the beginning of the game how the tight ends were not in the great graces of the coaches after last week. They realize they're still young, but they've really stepped up about four or five notches in this football game.
And 35-0, I think you have to be pleased with the effort right now. The balance between the run and the pass, the effort that's been out there from this Nebraska football team. Bo Pelini had this team ready to play. The fans have to love what they see. And going into the off weekend, as everybody approached this season, you thought, hey, if we can be 3-0 and be feeling pretty good about things, then we're going to feel good about Virginia Tech, and that's where they are right now.
Well, you know, this game is getting out of hand, so I'm going to turn over my play-by-play duty. You know, we've had some problems with our TV screens up here. So, Larry, the cable guy, would you mind doing play-by-play for me?
Well, yeah. Can I do it like a baseball announcer?
You can do it any way you want. It's.
Well, I'll tell you what, my Ireland Lockie is doing a good job. I thought we were down early in the first quarter, but we put it on trial there at the end. They pretty much came through.
Can you read any of this? I actually got you your own. It's somewhere over here. I don't know.
I got to tell you, I'm starting to get old. You know you're getting old when you start to trombone everything? Yeah, I can read it.
Trombone.
Oh, my God. Hey, it's unbelievable.
That's why I'm glad they put a bathroom here, because the older I've gotten, the gladder I'm glad I've got this thing in
I'm
here.
Telling you, I am old. I had a prostate check, and they found an arrowhead in there. So I don't know how old that is, but it's old. I got to go to an archaeologist to find out what's happening with me.
You've always got on the camo hat. You know, you're from from southeast Nebraska, so you get back here a lot. You enjoy coming to the games. Big fan. You always wear the hat on TV.
I always do. You know what? When I'm on Leno or Kimmel or whatever shows I'm doing, I always represent. I always try to wear something that's got Nebraska on it, unless I'm trying to get something free from a store, then I wear their hat.
Sounds like me.
Yeah, exactly. Work, I always got the Husker hat on. I'm a big Husker fan. Have been my whole life. Well, you're born in Nebraska. You got to be, right, Matt?
If you had to go out there and play
you're very attractive up close. Can I say that? Can we kiss on camera? Is that okay? Can we kiss on camera?
Just on the cheek.
I mean, in a friendly way, a guy way, you know.
I heard about your answering machine, by the way. We're not going to go into that.
So if they had to put you out there, if they had to put you out there for one series, what position would you play? And be most effective.
To be most effective? Punt returner. I got speed, my friend.
You think in the open field you can make somebody miss?
You know, in the open field, nobody can catch me. Seriously. I mean, look at this body. Well, you can't see it now. They're watching the game, but. What?
We're gonna let him finish this play, and hopefully.
Hold on now. All right, that was a good stop. But open field, look at this. This is a sleek deal.
You got the low
center.
That's
a whole Heisman deal. Look at that. I lost 50 pounds.
You did.
You know, that's an Olsen twin, so that's pretty good. You know? I was on Nutrisystem. It was great. I've lost 50 pounds. I feel good. And I actually did a marathon 2 weeks ago.
Is all right? How long did that take?
I did a Baywatch marathon.
Really? So, I want to know if you can do this.
Upside down.
You know what? Matter of fact, I did that last night.
Don't remember.
My wife was there, though.
And 30 seconds later, she thanked you.
That's right. He's back to pass over the middle. Cut to the 24. Rips his helmet off. Boy, that was a good play by number 20 there, 28. Hold on. That was a great play by – he's not even on the list, fellas.
We'll go over here.
Help me out here.
There we go.
Great play by Eric Hag. Eric Hag. Yes. I think I dated her once.
here's the route here.
You know, one of my favorite baseball calls of all time was Skip Carey.
Oh, yeah.
And Skip Carey, Ryan Klesko, he was one of my all-time favorites, and Ryan Klesko was playing left field. Great first baseman, couldn't play left field. They hit the ball to Ryan Klesko. He went in on the ball. He went back. He went to the left. He went back again. Then he dove and missed it. And Skip Carey goes, "You can't blame Ryan, folks. He's running the right route. We're just not getting the ball to him."
That's true. Ulbrich back to pass, looking down the sideline.
Oh, nice play.
Incomplete.
Incomplete. Broke up there by number 33.
You get to say that.
Prince Akamara. You know, what is it about our team? Akamara, and then you got that other guy on the defensive tackle there, the Nagada Kong. Holy moly.
And Damakong Su.
Damakong. Is that how you say it? Damakong Su?
Yeah. I mean, we've got some names here. And that is Tanars.
Tanars. I always say Tanarse.
As well.
Tanarse.
I probably said that tonight. The worst is doing Pac-10, though, Larry.
You know what? I don't even know how you got this gig, to be honest with you. I know all these names up.
I know somebody. That pictures of people, you know?
Now, that's a football name, Jared Crick. That's a good name.
Isn't it? It's a good
name. Strong name.
That sounds like a drink at, like, Shakri
Barfield.
Doesn't it?
Either that or the doctor. You got to help me. I think I got Shakri Barfield. Well, you better get that checked. It'll turn into the Damakong Su. I better. I'll tell you what, they're playing good today.
They are. I mean, this is a game that we wanted to see if they could run the football, and obviously they've been able to do that. Let's get them back over here so we can watch. Holbrook just throws that prayer up, and it's answered.
It's good to see Martin Lucky running the ball good tonight.
Yes. You know, and he's running aggressively. I mean, that's one of the things that we were wondering about after Western Michigan. Is he going to run the ball aggressively this year? We've seen him do that.
Yeah, and I tell you what, I like that Helu, too. Helu Jr.
Yeah, he runs hard as well. Let me ask you about Coach Osborne. I know
he's awesome.
Since he's been back, talk a little bit about the time you've spent with him and the friendship you've built.
You know, he always comes in the box and he says hi to everybody. He always says hi to your kids get him.
It's Colston down to the 30.
I'm not supposed to root for anybody, am I? This is supposed
to be. No, okay. We're pay-per-view. We're allowed.
Oh, okay.
It's not a problem.
Well, all right, then. But, you know, he's the greatest guy ever. And he just came over our box a little bit ago. It's funny. We were watching Jason. It's Jason's birthday today, by the way.
Oh, we didn't know.
34 years old. So So we're there watching Jason's interview, and some guy puts his arm around me, and I don't even think anything. I'm not looking because I'm watching Jason. I go, that's probably a buddy of mine or something. So I keep watching the interview. I look up. It's Coach Osborne standing with his arm around me for about 5 minutes. I was like, holy mackerel, it's the coach.
Pass is complete inside the 15 down to the 13-yard line. Is now New Mexico State showing a little effort offensively. Wes Niemann with the reception.
Yeah, he's a good guy.
Now you grew up in Nebraska. Yeah. Sorry, Ron. You grew up in Nebraska, small town, Pawnee City, down by my neck.
Yeah, down by Tecumseh. We played y'all in football, or tried to. You always beat us, but we tried to play in football.
So you always grew up being a Nebraska fan, so it was easy to come back all the time to the games, right?
Man, you know what? It's a thrill to be able to do this and to come to all the games. You know, when I grew up, we never got to go to the games. You know, we lived in a small town, farming community, and you couldn't. Oh, is that a fumble?
That is a fumble. The ball is loose. Still loose, and Nebraska's got it.
There you go. No offense to the New Mexico State fans about this. I love you all to death.
Zach Potter again. Last week, the interception. He batted a pass down. Tonight, he's blocked a field goal, and now he's disrupted the offense again, Matt.
Well, this is just a bad pitch. Potter gets his hand in there, knocks it back, and Chase Holbrook has a shot at it. But if I had Zach Potter coming at me, I might have a hard time jumping on it, too.
I got to tell you, man, I think I could take him. I mean, I'm not being cocky. I think I could take him in one-on-one for 30 seconds.
6'7", 280, you just got to go low.
That's what it is. That's the key.
You go
to the knees.
Go, just hit him where it hurts.
Chop him down.
You go low, they're pussycats. I've said that for years.
So, Larry, what are you working on now? What's going on with you now?
You know what? I got a Christmas special coming out on CMT, my co-host. And you talk about a strange pairing. You know, I made friends with this guy a long time ago, but my co-host is Tony Orlando.
Oh, how funny.
He's awesome. We did a Christmas special for VH1 uh-huh. last year. We're doing it for CMT this year. That comes out in November. And I'm also doing a thing on Cartoon Channel on Disney called Cars Tunes, uh-huh. called Mater Tales.
That's right.
So I'm doing a bunch of things called Mater Tales, and then we'll be working on Cars 2 coming out in 2012. So
Mater Tales.
You know, Mater, that was the funnest thing I ever did, doing that tow truck for Cars. And evidently, that is the highest-selling toy for Pixar, is that little tow truck.
I believe it.
So.
Now, how do you keep Foxworthy straight and bowling ball?
I got to tell you, these guys have been riding my coattails. I don't know how long. I'm trying to cut them loose, and I can't do it. But Jeff and I have been friends for a long time, you know. I met him when he was a small little Asian fella many years ago, and then all of a sudden he turned into this redneck guy. But we're really good friends. I talk to Jeff every week. I talk to Bill every other week.
Can you talk to Ron?
Yeah. Ron, he's got a diploma above his desk. And I said, what college did you go to? He said, no, that's a liquor license. I said, oh, man, he can drink that, Ron.
Well, I had XM radio, and I got to admit, from Omaha Airport Thursday night at midnight to here, he had me in stitches laughing. And then they followed it up with you.
I tell you, Ron is one of the funniest guys on the planet. But we all keep in touch. We're all good friends. And that blue collar comedy tour did was one of the funnest things. Really was a blast that we could all travel together.
Were you really on a bus together?
You know what? No, we weren't on a bus together. You know, in that last movie, we acted like we were on a bus together, but we just filmed one day traveling around on a bus. But no, we flew in separately. Okay. Believe me, all of us on a bus, there would be no blue-collar tour if that's the
case. My wife and I fly in separately. We won't ride on a bus together either, you know?
Well, the things they eat, these Texas guys, like Ron White, they've got, I mean, everything's got hot sauce, and, I mean, it's unbelievable.
Well, they just called that an incomplete pass.
I gotta tell you, I ate something Ron White made one time, and I don't know what it was, but I went to the bathroom on an electronic toilet, and I got a high score. All right, so I don't know what was in that thing.
Hey, Larry, I know you have you're sitting pretty far away and making the trek over here. We really do thank you.
I'm waving at my family now. I got all my friends and stuff. I don't know if they can see me or not. Yeah, they waving over there. Jason Peters over there, and my mom and my wife, Kara, and my two little kids, and they're all over there.
Oh, good. Hey, Larry, we appreciate you stopping by. We wish you the best of luck, partner, and everything you do. You're a true trooper.
Hey, thanks a lot.
We'll see you soon,
good to see you. Yeah, thanks for having me up, guys. This is a really fun night, and I love the Huskers, and go Huskers!
There you go. Thanks, Larry.
Thanks,
Larry.
Take
care, buddy. Good seeing you, man. Take care.
What was your name again?
I'm Ron.
Well, I know. I'm just kidding.
When you come to San Antonio, see, I'm just bucking for free tickets when you come to San Antonio.
So. You got him.
All right, buddy.
Half price, but you got him.
Half price, but I got him. I'll take it. Larry, thank you, brother. Take care, my friend. Larry the Cable Guy. I've been doing this 33 years. That was the funniest 10 minutes I've ever done.
Oh, my face hurts right now.
Face hurts.
Even when we weren't on camera, I couldn't hardly talk because I was laughing so hard.
My. Well, the moment can Nebraska continue to throw the shutout here. Third down and 6, ball's on the 9-yard line. They got to get to the 3. Of course, the key play in this was what we thought would have been a fumble, a lateral. Replay showed it was a forward pass, incomplete.
And that one looked like it could have gone either way. I'm a little surprised they changed it because it was, you didn't really have a great angle to see it.
And it's got to be conclusive evidence. Here's the look again. Oh, that is forward. That angle, you can tell he was in front of him. He was at about the 23-yard line, it looked like. Now the defense, though, playing extremely well. They've only given up 255 yards. The offense, 437 yards for Nebraska. You know, and Larry had the confidence to ask Bo yesterday, when are you giving the black shirts? Neither one of us were going to ask that. Larry, you were our MVP on that one. And he said, sometime.
I don't know that he gives it that much thought.
No, I don't think he does either.
I mean, I think he's waiting. And he's going to know when it's the right time. He's not going to have to think about it every day.
Here we go. Third down and 6. Ball's on the 9-yard line. Neiman and Perez in the backfield with Holbrook. And he's going to have to burn another timeout.
It's a 30-second timeout.
It'll be a 30-second timeout. Hal Mummy just trying to figure out how to get in the end zone here. Once again, this is their opening game. They were scheduled to play Nicholls State September 4th. Because of Hurricane Gustav, they had to move that. The latest they've opened since the 91 season. This is a team that keeps fighting, though. If you look in the past 2 years, 9 of their 17 losses under Hal Mummy have been by 10 points or less. So this team constantly fights.
Yeah, they do. I mean, I can't imagine starting your first game. You have over 40 practices before your first game. You just get tired of looking at each other. Tired of beating on each other. You just want to get out there and play a game.
Well, they said they had a mock game last Saturday night. I asked why. I said, we want to make sure all our pants fit. Actually, they were just tired of hitting each other. Third down and 6 from the 9. Final minute and 46 seconds here of the third. Perez and Colston now in the backfield. Nebraska with 3 down linemen. They're showing blitz. Here they come. Holbrook throwing it up for grabs. Is his feet in? No, he was out of bounds. Incomplete pass. The touch pass was there for Williams. Could not put the feet down.
And this was close. Ron, let me tell you, I think his foot was just on the line just from watching up here 6 stories up.
Yeah, that's tough. That's tough.
They might actually look at this one, too. So we're going to have a...
It's not a great angle, though.
It's under review.
Well, they are going to review it. Our third review tonight. One's been upheld. One's been overturned.
I don't know if there's going to be enough from that angle to be able to overturn it and change it. But it looked awfully close from that angle, didn't it?
I thought it did, too. And they're going to have to call upstairs. Carl Richens looking at it again.
Let's see if he bobbles it at all. Once he has possession, right there. Does it bobble? Looks like he has it. Ball's moving around a little bit. I don't think they're going to be able to call that a catch, although it looked from that angle as if his foot were in.
Yeah.
But you really can't see from that angle very well.
Terry Porter, the replay official. Joe Bradley, his assistant, up in the booth. And you'll see the bobble here. Boy, I tell you, he didn't have possession of that until he stepped out of bounds.
Nope, this is going to be a quick one.
Yeah, so I think it is, too.
Ruling on the field stands.
Fourth down from the 9-yard line. They've got to get down to the 3-yard line. They've already had one field goal blocked tonight, and Chase Holbrook's coming back out. They're going for it.
Why not, right? Any chance at all to come back in this thing, you better shove it in.
Here we go. The splits are wide. Holbrook, pressure coming, gets rid of it. Incomplete, penalty flag is thrown. They're going to call interference, I think, on Armando Murillo, and he's saying, my bad.
And I think he did have his arm around him.
Pass interference. Defense number 6. By rule, the ball is placed at the 2-yard line. Automatic first down.
See him. Yeah, the right arm was around almost the neck, it looked like. Marcus Anderson was the intended receiver. So they'll get it first and goal on the 2-yard line. 1:34 left to play in the third. Perez and Colston in the backfield. And they jump. Kyle Nelson, the tight end out of Waco, Texas. Oh, boy. Young man, you may want to go back to the sideline via Omaha.
That, if you're the Aggies right here, you just,
oh, brother,
just makes you sick. You have a chance to stuff it in. You're at the 2-yard line, and you have a mental breakdown, and that pretty much says it right there. Hal Mumme with his hands on his head.
That puts it back to the 7. Williams in motion. Holbrook, pressure. He's going down, and we've got a penalty flag. And Ndamukong Suh with his first sack of the year.
Great pressure from Nebraska's defense, and I think that's going to be a holding call. It'll be
holding. Offense number 76. Penalty declined.
It'll be declined. You'll see the pressure. And Ndamukong Suh ends up getting the sack right in the middle of the field. But Ty Steinkuhler really made this play. Got Chase Holbrook to do a little spin there. And once Steinkuhler got to him, that gave Suh time to get there and clean him up.
And they keep going back. It's now on the 14, second and goal. Here comes the pressure again, and he's going down again. Second sack of the night.
Watch Ty Steinkuhler right in the middle of your field. Watch the swim move right there. Ty Steinkuhler worked on his hands in the offseason when he was hurt. He wasn't able to practice all the time. You see the swim move there. And the last two plays have been made by number 43. Even though he doesn't get credited with the sacks, he is making big-time plays in the middle of that defensive line.
Third and goal now from the 22. 8 sacks already on the year. They had only 13 all of last season. And here comes the pressure again. Pass is incomplete. Boy. Oh, my. Interference is going to be called on Thorell. They bailed Holbrook out again.
Wow. You have a third and 22, and it's going to be
pass interference.
First down.
Defense number 23. The ball will be placed at the spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
Oh, my.
What a bailout. And I think it was a good call, but wow.
And again, Suh almost came up with it. He just went over his back.
You know, worst case scenario, if you're Thorell there, you let him catch it and you tackle him right there, and it's fourth down and 20.
Boy,
and
I know
it's hard to tell yourself that. And I don't even know if that was pass interference for sure. Didn't see it on that angle.
Well, not only do they get first down, but they get it first and 10, not first and goal. Ball's on the 20. Here comes the blitz. Holbrook throwing it up for grabs. Pass is incomplete. Intended for Wes Niemann, Eric Hague on the coverage.
And right now you can really see the tenacity this black shirt, potential black shirt defense has. We'll see if they earn those black shirts. But right now they're pitching a shutout and they don't want to allow the Aggies into the end zone. You can see that motivation.
This is a team that averaged 330 yards passing last year. They're at about 165 now tonight. Final 21 seconds of the third quarter, second and 10. Glenn, nothing doing. As we mentioned at the top of the show, these two teams have played twice before. 125 to nothing. New Mexico State has never scored against this Nebraska team.
57 and 68 to zero. And with one quarter to play, they've yet to put up a point in Memorial Stadium here tonight.
And we're going to take a break. Final quarter set to come. The Huskers in control. They lead it 35 to nothing.
Reserve.
Head to the final stanza on the verge of their third consecutive win and first shutout. They lead it 35-0. Let's take a look at the numbers from the through three quarters of play right now. And you can see that Nebraska already 22 first downs, but they're closing in at 450 yards, 327 on a very balanced attack for New Mexico State. That kind of surprises us a little bit. But I think one of the things you look at, not only the rushing yards, but the fact that Nebraska has not turned the ball over yet this year.
Well, those are the things that Bo Pelini was talking about this week, was not having those mental errors, which means penalties and mental breakdowns on the offensive line and in the secondary mainly. They haven't done that tonight. They haven't turned the ball over. And they've had great balance. Run for 259 yards through three quarters, over 400 yards of offense. You can't be upset about that. And it's 35 to nothing, by the way.
No, and also the tight ends have played better tonight. The defensive line, as we talked about in the open, continues to put pressure on, especially in the last few series there of the third quarter.
I think you could really see the passion and tenacity that this defense has really gained the last 3 weeks, and I think that's their coach really coming through and getting what he wants out of them. We saw it in the last series here, but this defense does not want to allow New Mexico State into the end zone, and don't be surprised here if they bring the house and try to get to Chase Holbrook on third and long.
They're down and 10, ball's on the 20. Couple of pass interference plays on this drive have really helped New Mexico State. Right down the middle, intercepted. Matt O'Hanlon up over the 20 to the 25-yard line. O'Hanlon, his first interception.
And that had to be a breakdown in the route, because I don't know where Chase Holbrook was throwing this football. Seemed to be three Huskers in the middle of the field. And it ended up being O'Hanlon that got underneath it and picked it off.
You know, if you pick a great story this year, it's that young man out of Bellevue, Nebraska. Last time he played defense, he was a junior in high school. He was going to go to South Dakota State, a D2 school back in 04. Decided to walk on here. Patrick Witt now in at quarterback for the Huskers. No defensive snaps prior to this season. Was a high school quarterback and running back, and he has done a nice job. As Patrick Witt making his second consecutive appearance. Right up the middle running with Castile. Witt got some playing time last week. The 6'4", 225 redshirt freshman out of Wiley, Texas.
These are valuable snaps too, Ron. Early in the season when you have opponents that you feel like you should handle, when you don't have much experience, and Nebraska says zero experience behind Joe Gans, it's really important you get Patrick Witt some snaps. And you just never know when Joe Gans could go out of the game with an injury. You never know what'll happen, not to mention next season. You want to get snaps for your backup quarterback.
And now Roy Helu gets his first down. Over 35, up to the 37-yard line. You know, when we talked to Sean Watson, you can barely see him there. He's on the right side there. There he leans over. Sean, get some camera time, buddy. Family's watching. But, you know, every offensive coordinator needs their backup to get their feet wet. Because, as you said, you never know what's going to happen. I mean, ask Matt Castle that.
Exactly. I think you were in college when Matt Cassel scored a or started a game last.
I think I was. They get it off to Helu on the little dump pass. He gets in New Mexico State territory. 17 yards on the reception for Helu. Derek Richardson on the stop as Nebraska continues to pile up the yards.
Especially if Patrick Witt can lead them down the field. That'll give him a lot of confidence. And these are the types of plays you want to start a quarterback off with. Comfortable, retreating from the defense, just dump it off to a back. That's a safe play. Get him some confidence.
And giving Joe Gans a little bit of rest. Off week next week, then Virginia Tech comes to town. Helu's going to be stacked up. They're going to lose about two on the play. Jason Scott leading the charge. But a good night for Joe Gans, 13 of 17. He threw for 158 yards and a touchdown. He ran for a touchdown, and he caught a touchdown.
Not a bad night.
I was going to say, not too bad. But can he play defense? There's Joe. A solid night. He, you know, and even he admitted, and the coaches were talking about some decisions that were questionable last week. I don't think he had any of those tonight.
I don't think so. I mean, that is an efficient night right there. He did what they asked him to do, and he did it with his legs as well.
Now the ball is loose, still loose. And New Mexico State has it, and this may be six. Helu's trying to chase him down from behind and not able to do it. No, they're saying he didn't get in, out at the two-yard line.
Boy, great effort from Roy Helu there to knock him out of bounds. Boy, this is just what you can't stand. You know, a fumbled snap. The ball bounces around. All the Nebraska players that are position players are downfield, so no speed to run him down besides Roy Helu. And great effort to knock him out. And I'll tell you what, this defense is not going to be giving up right now. They don't want to allow them into the end zone. They want to pitch a shutout.
What an effort, though, by Roy. Great job just extending to push him out of bounds. And Betts, I don't think, saw him coming. Now the defense. They're facing New Mexico State, who has it on the three-yard line, first and goal. Remember the last time they were in this situation. The defense stood up to the challenge. Low snap. Hand it off, and it's going to be six. Marquel Colston, the junior out of Modesto, California. His first touchdown as an Aggie.
And that is unfortunate for the defense. This play has been pretty effective throughout the evening for New Mexico State. Stack everybody up inside and give it to a speedster on the outside.
And the extra point by Hughes. And it is good. So Kyle Hughes helps New Mexico State get their first seven of the year on the board. And Hal Mummy's squad, though, still trails at 35-7. We're 2.5 minutes into quarter number four.
We're on a journey of discovery. A journey that is unlocking the secrets of disease at the genetic level. The result? Revolutionary cancer vaccines and research breakthroughs in Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease. And with every discovery, we provide new knowledge to thousands and new hope, one patient at a time. We've always been pioneers. It's the frontiers that have changed.
This is Nebraska, the home of champions. The nation's finest student athletes. Success in athletics, academics, and life. Nebraska, the power of red. Now, Bo wasn't pleased with the way things turned out there at the end. 12:31 left in the fourth. 35-7 is the score.
Well, you're going to see how they line up here. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 Nebraska players on the right side. So New Mexico State goes to the weak side with a little speed to the outside. And this was the reaction from Bo Pelini. How do you think he felt about that one?
I'm going to say he didn't like it. Well, it gives them something once again. Coach up tomorrow.
That's right.
You know?
But I'll guarantee you what made his reaction what it was that fumbled snap.
Yeah.
I mean, that is one of the most fundamental things in the game. You have to get the ball from the center to the quarterback. You wonder how many times Patrick Witt has been taking snaps, and with which center was he taking snaps from?
Right, right.
And so maybe that's something that you look at later in the season. And,
a little onside kick. I guess when you're down this much, you might as well start working on every part of your game. Hughes, he's going to kick it short. Penalty flag is thrown. It is Paul. I think Nebraska, well, Hal Mumme was signaling for a timeout.
A timeout before a kickoff.
can't say I've seen that. And there is a flag back at the 5-yard line. And let's listen in.
Illegal formation by the kicking team. Did not have four players on each side of the kicker when the ball was kicked. 5-yard penalty and 4-yard play. After keeps the ball, first down.
Didn't have four players on each side of the kicker when the ball was kicked.
You have to have four on each side. There's the exchange up front with Jacob Hickman, you'd think.
Yeah.
That Hickman would be putting the ball in the right spot. It looked like Patrick Witt maybe came out a little quick and just didn't get the ball before he started to back out from under center. He's going to get another shot here.
As he should. And he's joined in the backfield by Quentin Castile. 12:26 to play in the ball game. Nebraska has dominated. And there's Castile. Gets a block from the wide receiver, and he gets up to the 40-yard line of first down. Jason Scott is the one who made the tackle.
A couple of youngsters out in front. Will Henry at the wide receiver position. Ryan Hill, a tight end. Throws some nice blocks, and Castile not going out of bounds. Cuts up field, gets about four extra yards, and keeps the clock running.
You mentioned Will Henry. He had a great block. Something you did very well, I got to admit. I'm serious. You know, I mean, that was, you always said, cut.
Oh,
that's,
man,
what
we
Henry
were
did.
Chopping guys' knees out, man.
That's what Will did. It's a good block. First and 10, the Huskers in Aggie territory. The pitch back to Castile. He's got a convoy in front of him. Slowed up just a little bit as he crossed the 30-yard line. He'll be marked down at the 24. Derek Richardson finally pulling him out. He stutter stepped. I don't think he knew the guy was right behind him, though.
No, he was trying to wait for Javario Burks, who was out in front, trying to allow him to make a block. Castile looks good. Powerful runner. And when he gets it on the edge, he doesn't mind going north and south. I'll tell you that. Lowering the boom on somebody.
You gotta love it, though, when you see Burks out there running with him. As a back, you look down, you see your big left tackle in front of you.
Yeah, he's only 6'5", 325.
Yeah. Really? He blocked that full moon we had out tonight. They'll try it again. They like that left side. This time Castile keeps his feet, and he's able to get at least a yard out of the deal. Looked like he was going to lose a yard or two. And again, Jason Scott, who's been in a lot of tackles tonight, making the stop.
Could have gone out of bounds right there. Nope. Go upfield.
No.
Take on the contact.
Ended up actually picking up two on the play. Nice job keeping his feet as Castile getting a little workload. And it's good considering he had the fumble last week against San Jose State. Had a lot of green in front of him. He's already taken a couple of pitches.
Ooh.
And a couple of hits.
That was
That's
a collision.
A denture check. That's a denture check there. Finotti is the one that stood him up. Uli Finotti out of Hawaii. You know, I talked to the coaches about him, and he says he looks like a football player. Hits like one, too.
Wow, watch this collision. Boom. When Quentin Castile is going full bore, and he is stopped in his tracks,
yeah,
you know there's a little force on the other end.
He lost only 4 yards in 76 carries last year, Castile. He doesn't get stood up very often. with the pass. Got Castile. He's got room up the middle into the four, the three, the two, and stopped. 24 yards on the reception for Quentin Castile. And Richardson finally tripped him up. He only had 6 feet to go.
I like the poise of Witt here. He turns, there's a defender right. Oh, that was the play before, but when Witt gets out from under center, he has a defender right in his face, but he's still able to dump the ball off to Castile.
Coaches love this. When one team scores, you come back and answer right away. Witt looking, throwing, had a man wide open in the end zone, incomplete, intended for Drew Young. Witt knows he had his man. Witt, who threw for over 1,800 yards his senior year of high school.
And this is one neither one of them will ever forget, because you'll never be this wide open, and you're not going to have. It would have been a nice catch, but catch. Drew Young, you ask him after the game, and he'll tell you he should have had it.
Yeah.
But it didn't need to be that tough either. He just needed to put a little bit more air under it.
Second down and goal from the two. They go from the I formation, and again another fumbled snap. This ball is still loose. I think Nebraska may have gotten it back. We're not sure. We'll wait for the signal.
I don't see New Mexico State jumping up and down, so.
And again, it was Jacob Hickman who was snapping, and he also recovered it. Try to see. He just pulled away. Looked like he tried to, took about a before he had the ball.
Look at all those big feet and legs. The ball's just sitting there.
And Jacob corrals it. Third down. They lost a yard on the play. Young in motion. Tifa Tiller upended at the 2 yard line. So this will be the second time Nebraska has been stopped. Devin House on the stop, and they're going to go ahead and kick the field goal, I think. Second time they'll be stopped inside the 5 yard line. Nice tackle, though, by House.
That was a great tackle. And get Alex Henry a little bit of confidence back here.
There you go. They'll mark it at the 9 yard line. This will be a 19 yard field goal attempt for Henry. He's missed one tonight. No problem with that one. So Alex Henry has taken care of the miss, added another three on the board. 8:15 to play in the ball game. Huskers lead it 38-7.
Well, I didn't really do a lot of cheerleading. And I was usually on the sideline with headphones. And I was really pretty deep in thought. And but I would like to leave you with this, and that is, go Big Red.
For technology to advance as rapidly as it has, technology education must advance even faster. The University of Nebraska has built an institute that will impress even the world's most sophisticated technology-based companies. Because the world's most sophisticated technology-based companies help design the curriculum. We've always been pioneers. It's the frontiers that have changed.
In front of a crowd of well over 84,000, Nebraska has looked impressive tonight on both sides of the football. Over 500 yards offense. They've only allowed 244. And they lead it as we head with 8:15 left to play in the ball game. Out of town scores, Ohio State leading, or USC leading Ohio State at halftime, 21-3.
And a couple of Big 12 schools rolling. Texas Tech.
44-0 or something like that.
43-0, I think. Yeah. Oklahoma, I believe, is up 41-0 at Washington.
Poor Ty Willingham. He'll start out the year 3-0. Tough loss today for Gene Chizik, Iowa State. Tied up with Iowa 3-3. Iowa was able to pull that ball game out. Oklahoma State rolling today.
Tough one for the Pac-10 today.
Yes, yes it was.
Cal goes and gets beat by Maryland when favored by 2 touchdowns on the road. UCLA just gets hammered by BYU. Unbelievable.
And Oregon had to come from behind to beat Purdue today. And it'll be 3 yards deep. Julius Fleming, the freshman. Nice stop. Great move to the inside. He is run out of bounds at the 23-yard line. Fleming showing a little moves there. The redshirt freshman of Baton Rouge, Louisiana. He's one of the many running backs that Hal Mumme has turned into a wide receiver. He's got 3 on his team already. Hal's got a real talent for doing that.
I think he might have caught one in the quad there, little Charlie horse.
And J.J. McDermott back in at quarterback now for New Mexico State. McDermott played a little bit early on in this ball game. The sophomore out of Katy, Texas, Cinco Ranch High School. And they had movement in the backfield. Brandon Perez seems to be the culprit.
Prior to the snap. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
It's a good chance, though, for Carl Pelini to put some of the reserves in. Dennard is in at cornerback, and that was one of the things he was hoping. He says, I know I'm playing the kickoff team and all that, but I want to play for Carl Pelini on defense. He's getting the chance at cornerback. This is what you want to do. Get some of the young players in there in front of the crowd and all that.
And New Mexico State will still be throwing the ball, so
yeah,
do some good reps.
Up to the 20-yard line is A.J. Harris. Pickup of 2 on the play. Kenneth Buckley, I should say. Of course, Nebraska now has the week off. Did you like week offs early or late in the season?
I didn't like them at all.
Spoken as a true football
player. I didn't like them ever.
Yeah.
You know, you'd think maybe you'd want it late if you're injured. If you're a team that's beat up, then maybe you want it late. But having it early isn't bad either if there's things you need to work on and things you need to adjust.
Here's Perez. Running room up over the 30, close to the first down. Let's see where they mark it. It'll be about a yard short. As we head into 7 minutes left in the ball game. Will Compton or Phillip Dillard on the tackle.
I think this is going to come at a really good time for Nebraska,
right, actually.
And after a performance like this, I think it's perfect. You know, you can take some confidence into the off week, yet there's still things I know as a coaching staff, Bo Pelini and his staff will go pick this thing apart and
Absolutely.
Say, you know, they'll bring him back down to earth and say, you better get ready to strap it up because the next 9 games, all better teams than the first 3 Nebraska's played.
Here comes the blitz, and they bust it with a run. Perez gets the first down as he's close to the 40-yard line, up to the 39. Of course, that string coming up where after Virginia Tech, who was a winner today, comes, then you got to play Missouri, then at Texas Tech.
How about that stretch? Big hole through there.
Ran right by Cody Glenn. In these last few minutes, too, the defense, I mean, you look at those faces, you'd never know that they're up by a bundle.
Well, you want a team that wants perfection.
Donovan Roberts tackled right at the line of scrimmage. May picked up a half a yard.
Nice pursuit. This little handoff has worked well for New Mexico State tonight. That was nice pursuit from
Austin Cassidy,
who was a missile from the safety position.
His dad's Tim Cassidy.
Tim Cassidy, yep. Down at Texas A&M.
Was here.
Did a great job here
at
Nebraska.
Hope to see Tim in a couple weeks, as a matter of fact. Here's the rollout by McDermott. Oh, my. He tries to slide. And Eric Hague, I think, may have got a piece of the old helmet. There's Eric Hague.
Hey, you got to punish a quarterback.
Yeah.
He's not a running quarterback, but...
You're going to slide.
Oh, yeah, now, buddy.
I think the funniest story about Eric Hague, though, is everybody confuses him with Roy Heller. And he says he has to tell people, I'm not him. my advice, just go ahead and sign his name.
Well, there could be worse guys.
Yeah, really.
Heller's going to score a few touchdowns. Yeah. If people mistake you for him, you'd be like, yeah, it was a good run. I know. I can get better. Especially on campus, it wouldn't be too bad.
No, it wouldn't. On third down, nothing going on for Brandon Perez. He is stacked up right at the line of scrimmage as we go inside of 5 minutes to play in the ball game. Somebody tell Carl he's winning.
I'm sure they're pretty happy inside. They're pretty pleased.
I'll tell you what, I've spent 3 weeks now doing three games here, and I can honestly say I've in my three decades have never enjoyed 3 weeks more than being around Bo and Carl and Sean Watson and Coach Brown, Coach Eckler, all of them.
Well, I think you can see how these players are going to want to play hard for the staff. And having Coach Osborne above that guy, Bo Pelini, right there, I mean, character is back in this program at the highest level.
He's not only put the D back in dignity, he's put the D back in defense. So we've got 4 minutes and 4 minutes and 12 seconds left to play in the ball game, 38-7. Defense has done a nice job. Only 271 yards for New Mexico State out of town. Of course, Missouri, a big winner today. It was close early on. Oklahoma in the third, pitching the shutout against Ty Willingham and the Huskies. Texas Tech looks like they're finally getting their offense going. June Jones saying, can I go back to Honolulu? As he trails 43-0. Now, if you look at this game seriously, just and look at what we've seen so far tonight, there's been some good things. There's been a couple of little bobbles. I think kickoffs into the end zone may be a small concern. What grade would you give this team?
Pretty good. A minus, B plus, right in that range. I mean, I just saw so many good things. More than anything, it's been the effort tonight and just the willingness to really sacrifice on defense. You could see that tenacity on defense. And they just made plays. They played with pride. They played with passion. New Mexico State was able to move the ball a little bit, but once they got in the red zone, Nebraska's defense really stiffened. Zach Potter played another big game. They forced a couple of turnovers. And so, I'm pretty pleased. And then you look at the offensive side, and there was that balance, Ron. And that's what Nebraska's going to have. These first three games were the first part of the season. Then you kind of look at the next nine and where they need to get better. You look up and down the Big 12 Conference, and you're going to have to play good football every week to get a win. We've seen what the conference did this weekend. If Kansas would have won last night, it would have been a really good weekend for the conference.
Absolutely, but running the football has been a real key tonight for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. They've rushed for nearly 300 yards in this ball game. So people that were about to push the panic attack button that they weren't running it, they've been able to do it. Here's fourth down and four. Nebraska brings four. McDermott throws it deep down the middle, has a man, incomplete. Overthrown at the 20-yard line. It looked like Todd Lee had a step on the defense, but the ball just didn't get there. And now Zach Lee may be coming in at quarterback for the Huskers.
McDermott has a man down the middle of the field.
No, he's got two steps.
Thorell was a little bit behind there. Missed him. So now Zach Lee. And Zach Lee might be the best athlete at quarterback for Nebraska.
Yes. There you see San Francisco. His father, of course, longtime NFL player, Bob Lee. Sophomore, 6'2", 210 pounds. Went to San Francisco City College. First appearance in a Husker uniform.
5-yard penalty, still first down.
Marcus Mendoza, number 32, also in on the backfield. Now in the open, we talked about the running game, and it was the three-headed monster. Here's what they've done tonight. Roy Helu, 7 carries, 32 yards. How about a 4.6 average? You look at what Marlon Lucky cracks the century mark. Joe Gans, nice job. 7.5. I'm not a mathematician, but that's pretty good average.
Well, that is really impressive and much different than what we showed at the beginning of the game.
Here goes Mendoza. He's a speedster, turning it on inside the 20-yard line. Marked down at the 15, 35 yards on the carry. The longest for Mendoza, and he's pumped.
Just as we're talking about the offensive line, look at this hole. And a little bounce to the outside. Receivers blocking downfield. Chris Brooks gets the block. Springs Mendoza to the outside. And once these guys start to get confidence in the running game, Ron, which is really what I think this coaching staff wanted them to get this week heading into the off week, you know, you start to believe, hey, we can run the ball on anybody. And Marcus Mendoza, although he might be fourth string, he can get it done.
Well, and the coach is telling us after the Western Michigan game, we got to get this kid in because he's one of the fastest guys we've got. They like him, the freshman out of Houston, Texas. Had an outstanding high school career, but they like that he's got another gear. We saw it there on that 35-yard pickup inside of 320 to play. Nebraska knocking on the door again, over 550 yards offense for the Huskers tonight. Less than half that for New Mexico State. 332 yards rushing, 218 passing for Nebraska.
Just a dominating performance.
Very much so. This time Mendoza tries to get to the outside, cuts back. We have a penalty flag thrown right at the 15-yard line. Maybe picked up three on the play with 2:50 to play.
Holding. Offense number 89. 10-yard penalty. Repeat secondary.
Hunter Tiefertiller with the infraction. And it's also good to have that young man back, Tiefertiller. That gives you three, four solid tight end position or players at that position.
And we know a week ago, the performance by the group of tight ends collectively was not good.
Right.
And so having, I think, that presence of a guy that's been around the block a little bit is really going to, he's going to be a mentor for those younger guys. Bring some experience.
Got a lot of the second teamers on the offensive line in now. Drew Young moves to the left. The pitch, Mendoza. This time, nice pursuit, and that is exactly what Joe Lee Dunn's defense is supposed to do. Let's go down to Larry on the sidelines.
Well, thanks, Ron. You know, you can tell the game when it's tight and almost over because the Pelini kids jump over the fence and get on the sideline. The Gilmore daughter is over there. This is a very family-oriented coaching staff. You know, Bo comes in, takes his kids in the morning to school, comes in late in the day. Shouldn't say late in the day, but certainly later in the morning. A lot of people have this impression that he's a very intense kind of guy. Certainly is on the field, but an intensely family guy as well. In fact, the people who know him well says he's one of the biggest pranksters on the staff.
He owes me a box of Clark bars. That's all I know. The people at the club in Youngstown better be sending him a box of Clark bars. Pass is incomplete for Zach Lee.
Wes Comick was open out there in the flat. It looked like it was a little bit behind him, but one that Comick maybe should have caught.
We talked about their record, never losing under the lights to an unranked team. The only losses have come to ranked teams, Washington, Texas, and USC, 25-3 under the lights. Make that 26-3 now with 1:47 to play.
And those are three pretty good teams.
Yeah, it's not
And
too.
The Texas game in 0-2 could have gone either way for sure.
Absolutely. Zach Lee off balance, throws, passes complete at the 23-yard line on fourth down and a bunch. Kamek again on the reception, and at least Zach got a pass in as New Mexico State will take over with 1:42 to play in the ball game. I want to take time to thank everybody from both New Mexico State and Nebraska, especially Keith Mann, Chris Anderson, everybody on the Nebraska coaching staff for being so gracious to us these last 3 weeks on the pay-per-view games. And look forward to coming back here in the next couple weeks, hopefully. Or at least this season.
Make our jobs easy, don't they? Production crew here at Fox and everybody at the sports information at the University of Nebraska and New Mexico State.
Tim and Tom in the truck and everybody's been up here in the booth with us. Thank you.
Really, we're just robots.
Spotter. I got a new spotter, though.
There you go.
I hate to tell my guy's been with me 15 years. He's gone, but everybody's done a great job. Thank you.
We just really spew information that they give us. That's it. I mean, we're robots. Anybody could do this. Larry the Cable Guy can do it.
As the kids are coming on the field now. Yeah, this is great. I think they see Daddy. Yeah.
Coach Gilmore, his kids.
Daddy, can I have a dollar for a snow cone?
Some kids will never get to experience that one time.
That's right. That's right.
But something they'll never forget.
You know, and we talked to Bo extensively prior to the Western Michigan game about family, and it's something very special to him. In fact, we were kidding him that his family finally left after the first 2 weeks of the season. No offense, Politi family in Youngstown. Yeah, and I think Coach Osborne had the greatest line. He says, people from Youngstown don't leave. But he really is that way. For those of you Nebraska fans who have never met Coach Politi, you know, I'm kind of a cynical guy, but not with him. Handoff goes to Perez as we go inside of 1:35 to play. A lot of recruits here today. Philip Dillard's brother, I think, from Jenks High School in Tulsa, Oklahoma, had a tough loss to Tulsa Union last night. Got up at 4:30 in the morning, and his dad drove him here. Walking around, one of the many recruits that are taking a look at the Huskers now.
Look at that.
1:11 to play. Huskers 38-7. Once again, next week off, and Virginia Tech comes to town. Five straight home games to begin the season. Pass floats up in the air, caught to Fleming, and he is going to be corralled at the 20-yard line. Eric Haig brought him down. 62 yards on the pass play from McDermott to Fleming. Wow.
That was a great throw and catch. And what a catch at the end of it. I mean, there's a minute to go, so whatever. You want to go deep, that's fine. But, wow, fingertip catch.
And he had to kind of turn it on the extra jet just to get that final yard to get underneath that. So now what's the crowd is back into this ball game. They try to run the football. Perez may have gotten a yard. And we have another blown shoe on the field.
I don't understand that. How do your shoes come off?
That's the second time it's happened to him.
Every game you see somebody lose a shoe.
They got loafers on?
I mean, lace them up, boys.
Yeah, really? It's like helmets popping off. Put both snaps on. 25 seconds. Clock is running. Second down and six. Ball's on the 16-yard line. Fans don't want the score. They're going to hand it off to Perez. He'll get down to the 10-yard line, close to the first down. Looks like it's going to be short. And hell, Mummy's going to call a timeout.
Yeah, he might run one play here, maybe kick a field goal.
Hell, Mummy, who's one of the first assistants he hired at Iowa Wesleyan, was a guy by the name of Mike Leach, who followed him to Valdosta State, followed him to Kentucky. Mike pretty successful now. Take a look at the next four games for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Following the off week, Virginia Tech comes to town. Frank Beamer winning today. And then Gary Pinkel in Missouri. Then you have to go October 11th to Texas Tech. And then at Iowa State, Gene Chizik's squad, who had a tough loss today. Very important. And that conference just doesn't get easy this year.
It's just difficult every week. You know, you go on the road to Texas Tech, and after playing three straight tough games, then you go to Iowa State. And, yeah, that's a game you feel like you should win, but you never know. After three tough games, it's kind of a trap.
Yeah.
It's a game that you maybe take for granted. Who knows what happens in those other three. Then you come home for Baylor. New system, new quarterback, athletic quarterback.
Big win over Washington State last night. 13 seconds left, third down and a yard to go. McDermott looking, has a man. They'll throw it away. He had a man right on the goal line. That pass is intended for Todd Lee. But it looked like Kenneth Buckley was just standing on the goal line.
Yeah, I think he had a man open in the end zone. See what Hal Mummy's saying there to McDermott. Underneath, I think he had a man.
Yeah, 81, Kenneth Buckley was wide open. Carl Politi says this game's not over yet. I still have 8 seconds. All right. Fourth down and one from the 11. McDermott looks, throws, passes incomplete.
No. Oh, my goodness. Oh, you've got to be kidding me. That ball was so far behind him, it was uncatchable.
Oh, brother. Major Culbert is going to be called for. And, you know, this is a point of contention, too. They stressed. And
pass interference. Defense number 54. Ball is played at the 2-yard line. Automatic first down.
As as we look at it, go ahead and do this, because I got to say something would happen in July at this conference. What they said is, listen, don't make a call if the game's almost over and it means absolutely nothing. And they talked about it. These officials, I sat with these guys and they said, don't make that call. It means nothing.
So Nebraska will take a timeout here to make sure and get their defense set. And Bo wants to have a little bit of a discussion with that official.
I mean, I've got my notes in my briefcase on that, and I went up to the NFL guy and said, are you sure? He goes, absolutely. He was heading this seminar. He said, you know, don't make a call if it means nothing to the outcome of the ball game and you have 5 seconds left. Why call that play?
It's, you know, if you're a defense that's played your heart out and the only 7 points that New Mexico State has comes on a fumble return down to the 2-yard line.
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's probably a shutout. And now you're thinking about giving up another one with 2 seconds to go on a meaningless snap. I mean,
my goodness.
They're going to play. I don't know if New Mexico State will score on this play, but I'll guarantee you Bo Pelini was in that huddle getting his guys jacked.
Yeah. Now they got first and goal from the 2. This will be the final play of the ball game. From the shotgun for McDermott. Looking, throwing, in the corner, incomplete, game is over. And Nebraska will go to 3-0. Bo Pelini now 4-0 as a head coach of the Huskers. And Hal Mumme's squad put up a pretty good fight, and they begin the season with a loss. Final score again, 38-7. The Huskers win it. We'll be back to wrap things up right after this. Stay with us.
This is Nebraska, the home of champions, the nation's finest student athletes. Success in athletics, academics, and life. Nebraska, the power of red.
The International Quilt Studies Center and Museum weaves together history and artistry. With thousands of quilts from dozens of countries, the Quilt Center houses the finest public collection in the world. World-class collections. That's the power of red.
Honor the past and invest in the future by contributing to the new Nebraska Student Life Complex. Located on the west side of Memorial Stadium, the Student Life Complex will nearly triple the size of Nebraska's Hewitt Center for Student Athletes, providing current and future Huskers more space, resources, and technology to continue Nebraska's rich academic tradition. For more information, go to Huskers.com.
And welcome back to Memorial Stadium. The Huskers over the Aggies 38-7. Joining me now is Bo Pelini and family. A renewed effort to run the ball tonight, it appeared.
Yeah, you know, we came out, we said we wanted to make a statement with our physicality. That's where we thought we could make the difference in this football game, and I think we did that. And you know, they play a finesse style ball, and we, you know, we weren't sure where they were going to line up, so we tried to keep it simple and get after them.
Defensively, this team continues to show more and more confidence. Do you see that out there?
Yeah, I think they're. We did some good things, and but there's still a lot to improve upon. But I like the effort. I like the effort, and I like the attitude. And if we keep going down that road, we'll just keep getting better.
Well, thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
All right, Larry, good job tonight. Let's take a look at the final numbers. And 553, that's kind of Nebraska of old, isn't it?
553, over 300 yards rushing. And the other thing was play selection. 44 rushing attempts, 24 passes. You know, they really put an emphasis on it during the week. The players came out and they executed. Mm-hmm. And Bo Pelini said it this week before the game. He said, when we execute, we're pretty good. And when we act like we have youth out there and we have guys that don't have experience, then we're not very good because they make mental errors and they have penalties. And when they don't do those things, this team's going to be tough to beat.
Because you look at the penalties from last week and some of the blocking errors, a lot of it were the first and second year guys.
Yeah, and it was communication.
Right.
Me not telling you what to do. Like, you had to tell me what to do all night, you know, just so I knew exactly what to do. So, but, you know, these young guys, they make mistakes, and sometimes in a big game, they were in a tight one last week, and they saw some mistakes. So coming out here tonight, I think, gives those guys confidence again. Now they have an off week, and they get ready for Virginia Tech coming in here in 2 weeks.
There's really no rest, though, because there are so many things that coaches want to tweak, but I think what Bo Pelini was really looking for tonight, not only execution, he was looking for a physical football team, and I think he got that tonight, both sides of the football.
Lydon Murthaugh being back at right tackle really helped, gave a boost, I think, to that offensive line with Matt Slauson and Lydon Murthaugh on the same side, and they ran over those guys a lot of the night, and Domikang Suh and Ty Steinkuhler caused a lot of havoc up front, and how about Zach Potter?
Right,
He is Johnny on the spot. He makes big-time plays. The defensive line maybe took another hit tonight with Pierre Allen going out with an injury. We'll follow up on that, but, you know, the running game, controlling the line of scrimmage is really what Bo Pelini wants to get back for this Nebraska football program.
Well, there you see Marlon Lucky breaks the century mark. Nice job by Roy Helou. Joe Gans rushes for a touchdown, throws for a touchdown, catches a touchdown. Quinton Castile, 75 yards on 10 carries. All in all, a good night for the running attack of the Huskers. Of course, they're off next week, and then Virginia Tech comes to town. Final score again, Nebraska wins at 38-7. Tonight's Nebraska-New Mexico State game is an exclusive presentation of FSN. Thanks for joining us the last 3 weeks. And remember, check your local listings for upcoming games on FSN pay-per-view. For producer Tim Papps, director Tom Williamson, Larry Putney, Matt Davison, I'm Ron Thulin, saying good night from Lincoln, Nebraska.